This is the South Florida Radio Network. The South Florida Radio Network presents The Jorge Rodriguez Show. To reach Jorge or Boca, call 954-990-0036. To reach Jorge on WGBS, dial 954-990-0036. And to reach Jorge on WNWS, dial 954-990-0036. Should those two stations no longer exist, just dial 954-990-0036. And now, The Jorge Rodriguez Show.
Mornings are mornings. And then there's the Neil Rogers Show.
Come after us, they're going to put us in jail. You got to cut it out, you got to stop.
On continuous douchebag radio, 94.9 Zeta 4.
Hostile, hysterical, lunatic friend, you old douchebag, you old douchebag. I bet you're old enough to be Joey Reynolds' mother. I bet you're old enough to be Joey Reynolds' mother. I bet you're old enough to be Joey Reynolds' mother. Come on, you sick old bag. You pathetic old douche. Pathetic old douche.
You got a point, too. It's right at the top of the head, you jackass.
Because they're not all as brilliant as you are, you old bitch. You old bitch. Ooh. You old bitch.
You know, I've heard that word on Cheers.
Yeah.
And it's, other words that
we
can't
not,
say.
We will not
Cheers.
Accept any restrictions on that particular word, okay? Well, that's where we draw the line. I mean, if you hear it on WGN.
We say it in the play.
Or most of their words are gee golly, aw gosh, and holy cow.
Holy cow.
And
big
only
one.
Harry Carey's allowed to say that.
Holy cow!
Thanks for the memories of your days at INC. Zeta 4 and KAT, and now you work for Cox, and Cox is good enough for me. Yes, thank you, Uncle Neil. Thanks for the hemorrhoids. Joey Reynolds, Randy Rhodes, Gary Bruce, Drew Michaels Show, and every other pain in the ass that's been through IOD stores. Yes, thank you, Uncle Neil. 20 years in this stinking business, and you haven't changed a bit. Even though you had to take their shit from PDs to GMs, they're all like big BMs. Yes, thanks for the memories of hockey and the bird. And yes, those floating turds. And now that we think of it, your gentlemanly words, like f*** you,
wow. I needed more time, Boca Brian. I'm not done Facebooking this. This is a very momentous occasion over here. I'm not even done with my cough drop, for crying out loud. And he can't answer back. We can talk to him. This is an amazing thing, because talk about a first time for a lot of things. Steve Kane, Craig Worthing in the studio with me. Never done a show with these guys. I was starting to tell you, but then you turned and started talking to that guy. My very first training session in the talk radio industry was on the Steve Kane Show. You probably don't remember.
Really? You're kidding me.
No, I'm not kidding you. I tell people that story all the time. With Nick Lawrence. That's why I called him. We're going to be calling Nick Lawrence. I'm getting him on here. But I knew nothing. I was a music DJ for 4 years.
Right.
I come to this town. I try to get a DJ job. We know how funny that is. I'm walking into the radio station. Hey, y'all want to hire me? I'm a DJ. Here's my demo tape. And they laughed at me. Well, actually, they ignored me completely. So I went and repoed cars for a couple years until I decided I missed radio. Got back on at IOD. I was interviewing at Wins in IOD, but IOD had all these things going on, like news and talk. And I thought, let's see what this is all about. And I hated it, by the way. But my very first session Walked into that control room. The board looked like a 747 compared to the board that I was using in Montana, which was just seven pots with seven knobs, you know, knobs and switches. That's all it was. Very simple, very easy to understand. And I was pretty good at that, segueing music and everything. Say something, Craig, so that people know that you're here.
I can't get over the smell of that awful cough drop.
I smell like a koala bear.
I'll
tell you what, we'll be drinking. I'll get some alcohol out, and then you can enjoy my gin breath. How's that? So that was my first training session. Gary Bruce hired me. Maybe we'll get Gary Bruce on the air. If not today, then some other time.
I was confused. The part of the story was I was...
You were on the air, and that was my first session. Okay. They told me to show up to work at a particular time to start my training as a talk radio board op, and if I do a good job, I could be a talk radio producer. And I said, all right, let's see what this is all about.
That was the beginning.
My impression of talk radio was Paul Harvey and Bruce Williams. This is what I was aware of, and I didn't listen any further than that because I thought I like to listen to music, and I thought this is boring, stodgy shit. This is for old people, and that was what I thought. So I'm just taking a job. For me, it was like taking a job as a talk radio board op was like taking a job digging ditches or something. But I needed some money, and I didn't want to repo cars anymore. So you were my first training session. I got to see Nick Lawrence produce the Steve Kane show. My very first time on the board with Nick leaning over me was during your show, and you probably don't even remember that.
From that humble beginning.
Right, because of your Alzheimer's.
Here we are.
Ruling the world, raking in money. I need
hand over
lawn baskets. I need lawn leaf baskets to rake in all the money. It's like being a Coke dealer, the money that we're making over
here. Right, you're breaking great new ground here. It's very, very exciting. To watch the business evolve.
This is where everyone is going anyway. This is where everyone is winding up. And I'm not doing anything really, really original because I'm patterning a lot of what we're doing over here after WIOD. I was very lucky to get a job at a radio station. I didn't realize it at the time. I realized it, eventually, that something really huge was going on here. Because I wasn't like a radio idiot. I knew what was going on in radio, and I knew that for an AM station to be dominating a market, with no promotion really, because you certainly remember that there weren't, big old billboards, and we weren't on the sides of buses.
Little or no promotion.
Little or no promotion, and still, that station dominated the market for 12 hours pretty well, and even in the evening times. With Hank and Stan and the sports talk, the sports talk was so successful that it spawned an entire radio station. When they made WQAM, Greg Reed hired everyone from our sports department over there, and that was WQAM.
When I came over to IOD, it started a major war between the sports department and the talk department.
Right.
Because it was the year, I don't know the number of the year, but it was the year that the Dolphins decided to go out on strike.
Okay.
And I was a huge football fan, and I was going to be missing my football because these overpaid, spoiled brats, weren't earning enough money. And so I started a movement on my show called SST, Support the Second Team.
Okay.
And, of course, we were the Dolphin station.
Right.
And I remember Hank Goldberg calling me out in the hall, and we practically got into a fistfight. The Dolphins decided they were going to boycott their own station because I was leading this movement.
Scandalous.
It was scandalous. But and it's very interesting, and it relates to Neil, too, in a way, because Hank and I, in those days, Hank really... I basically like everybody, but there are a lot of people that don't like me, and Hank was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And then when Hank got fired, I called him on the phone, and I said how unfair I thought it was, and that I felt really badly about it. And we became friends, after we were no longer working together. And same with Neil. I mean, when I went to see him at the hospital, I asked before I came. I didn't think it was right. I didn't want to do like Fred Sanford, give him the big one. I didn't walk in and want to see him have a stroke saying, get
jump
that
in with
bastard
a scary mask.
I asked Craig, as a matter of fact, to act as an intermediary. I said, I'd like to pay my respects to Neil and see Neil, but I don't want to just come in, ask him if he would be receptive to that. And Neil was
funny.
Very nice about it.
Craig Worthing is here, and originally, because, Steve's an afterthought, I invited Craig to be on the show because Neil would talk about Craig all the time. Neil liked Craig. Neil considered Craig a friend and would always talk about how you used Craig as a guinea pig. Is that
did
true?
Did he ever give you any specifics about that?
Like with the LASIK surgery and all these other things?
Yeah, that's true. That's a true story. Not with my president.
Steve used Craig as a guinea pig.
Not with my, I didn't put it that way.
Please, you put
it
on about six different things.
What were the other ones?
What were the pills you had me take? I only masturbate once a month.
You're talking about the erection injection?
You put me on the erection injection, the eye operations. I had to go to Houston on because they screwed up.
That generated songs. We have comedy bits about your erection injections. I heard stories, Steve Kane, about you going to work with sweatpants so that you could show people how amazing the erection injection thing worked.
There's more to that.
Please.
You're like
your thumb is bigger.
You were pitching tents. Pup tents, from what I hear.
As a matter of fact, the first time I tried it, it was late in the day, and I was so excited. The greatest part about the erection injection, I called my wife. It was like 5 o'clock, and the kids were still up, so there was no going home to use it because the kids were up. And I went to the stage. I was so excited about it. The most exciting thing about the erection injection is observing people's reaction to it. I had the shot. I walked into a restaurant, and I'm wearing jeans. Actually, it wasn't sweatpants. It was jeans, and they were tight jeans. And I walked in the door, and it's amazing how many people watch crotches. It's like every eye in the place. I was embarrassed.
When you're sporting wood, you're going to turn heads. Come on, you know that.
Yeah. Well, no, I don't. I don't do this as a whole. For the most part.
I heard. When you left IOD, where did you go? You went to Wins or what?
WNWS. Okay. I've been at every station. I was at WNWS for a while. Then I moved to IOD, which is an interesting story. And Neil was not at IOD when I first came
there.
Right,
he's still on Zeta.
He joined in Progress. And then from IOD, I did a year in New York at ABC, and then I came back and started WFTL, which was my piece de resistance, because I was the program director. You know how you go through business, through the years in the business, working for, I can say it, I love this freedom, asshole.
Yes.
Program.
Yes.
They can't do that on
relax. You can fart
asshole.
For real. As a matter of fact, if you do feel one coming on, just grab the microphone and shove it up your ass so we can enjoy the residence.
Still unpleasant for me. I would rather not do that.
Okay, well, good. We have open windows.
Anyway, and you know, you work for assholes your whole life, and you always say, geez, if I was only a program director, and of course I got my chance at WFTL. We put together our own station, and it really turned out pretty good. I'm finished, Craig. Your turn.
Craig. No, I'm listening to it.
I even hired Craig.
That's so good.
That's where Craig comes in.
Craig goes all the way back, because one of the things that we want to do here is I have my memories of Neil always. They go back far, but his history in this town goes back, 36 years? 30?
I came down in 73, so I started.
So you were there. You were there with him, and so I really wanted to.
A lot of people made promises to me,
paint
and
this
I sit
picture.
Here on my ass with not a penny.
You too. I want to paint this picture of Neil's career down here from the perspective of the people that worked around him, and that was my rationale for having Craig.
Well, that was one of the reasons I wanted you to have Steve too, because Steve could pick up where I left off, because I was with the early years of Neil, and then Neil moved on to great riches.
Let's see if we can paint it in. Yeah.
Well, actually, you moved on before Neil moved on.
Not to great riches, no.
I mean, we know Neil started at KAT. Were you there at the time?
No, I came down. I was first at INZ for about a year, opposite Alan Courtney, who was the big honcho, with the idea that I would go against him. And then they dropped talk at INZ at night, and I went to IOD, following Larry King, right? Sally, Jesse, one of the two.
Sure.
And I was doing all nights Courtney, with the idea that if he died or something, I would move into Courtney's slot. And I was doing midnight to 6 with two breaks, with a news break at 2 and 4, a long shift.
Yeah.
And I was there about a year, and I went on vacation, and my friend Larry Kent, the late Larry Kent, filled in for me. And he called me about 2 days after vacation, management changed, and they decided to drop me on the all-night talk show. So luckily, that's when I went to KAT in 75. And 1 year later, I was on from noon and from 10 until 2, making $400 a week.
Hey, Big
I remember this exactly because in came this guy from J&O named Neil Rogers.
Okay.
And he was making $250. It's the only time that I made more money than Neil Rogers, right? And the first time we met, he told me he was gay. Nobody ever told me they were gay outright. He lived right up the street from me, and I had two little children. After my divorce, I had custody, fortunately, at that time. And so we did everything together. We went to Disney World together. Went to all the different things with my kids and Neil. Neil was part of the family. So I bring this up for a reason. On my show, I talked about what I did. I talked about, well, Neil and Tracy and Terry and I went to this place and that place over the weekend. And my kids looked upon Neil like an uncle, and he loved the kids.
Great.
And then after we were together, he was doing news talk back then, basically. In late 78, I think, 78, yeah, he decided he was bored with radio and talk radio and really didn't like it. And for some reason, he decided he was going to come out of the closet. We sat up for a couple of nights.
The Anita Bryant thing was going on.
Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't, please. It's going to ruin you, Neil. Well, sure enough, Neil didn't listen to me, and he came out of the closet. Well, the worst part about it at that particular time is I got all the hell. People would call me on the air and say, are you at the top or the bottom?
Really? You think you got that? What
do you let your kids watch? Neil got very little negative. I got the negative because I
my kids take
about,
pictures.
You
should have said that.
Oh, so what did you say when you got those calls?
I would make jokes when they say, you know, are you the top or the bottom? I'd say you have to come watch it, or do you let the kids watch?
Right.
Only on Thursdays. Little things, you
right.
know. But I got letters. I got them home. Neil got hardly any negative. I got all the gosh darn negative.
That sounds familiar.
But Neil and I...
But Neil says something and you get beat up over it, yeah.
Yes, I'm sure that sounds familiar.
Neil and I were very, very close. And then as he moved on to whatever station it was next, I don't know if it was INZ, I think it was.
I picked him up at... I mean, we crossed paths for the first time at WNWS.
Well, our friendship, unfortunately, started to, you know, different places, different people. And then the pussycat came along. Remember the pussycat?
Sure.
And so Neil called me and asked me to come over to his house. I spent 2 days with Neil and all of his friends. Nobody called. Nobody visited. And for the first night, Neil said, we can't stand just sitting around here. And as anybody who knows Neil, he loves harness. He dragged me over to Pompano again. We had dinner. He bet on the harness racing over there. And I spent those couple of days. It was very hard for Neil. And then, of course, you didn't help it, Steve, because that's
well, I started all the trouble.
You started with the bumper stickers.
Bastard.
And all the,
now we used to jump way out of chronology.
Oh, no,
way out of
bumper
chronology.
Stickers with the hand?
No, that was way later.
Well, was it?
That
no.
was a WN. That was a WFTL.
I don't know, because you were a prick. Let's face it.
What did the bumper sticker say? I'm trying to remember.
I have one at home, but I didn't bring it.
Coming. Was after Neil had a rather unfortunate run-in with the police at an adult theater.
Yes.
Actually, I think it was a heterosexual theater.
A pussycat.
Yes, it was. Yeah. Right.
And we, in the spirit, of course, just of levity and lightheartedness,
we produced
bumper stickers that had a picture of a fist.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the wording on the bumper sticker was... Coming soon in a theater near you.
Spell C-U-M-M-I-N-G.
Yes. It was
nice.
funny at the time.
Well, a collector's item
in
if you
retrospect,
still have that.
Yes, absolutely. You know, I heard they're going for as much as $500 as
well. Well, Neil really? Thought at the time it was going to wreck him. He thought he was through.
Not my bumper sticker.
Well, no,
you're talking
the whole,
about
the
incident.
The pussycat situation.
Yeah,
he thought was things were over.
But you jumped way, way ahead. You jumped
from
82.
How can I keep track of your nastiness?
Well, you I mean, I joined the scene. You want to talk about my nastiness? Joined the scene. I came from Orlando, where I had been working with a fellow named Gene Burns, a very talented guy. He used to be out of Boston, then came down to Orlando, and I was earning like $200 a week, and I was doing live spots. I was always very talented at live spots, getting my own sponsors, and I was earning 50 cents per live spot. And I forget exactly the circumstances of my leaving that job, probably a good story because I blocked it out, but I was out of work for about six weeks in Orlando, and then I got a call. They were looking for a talk show host at WNWS down in Florida, and I came down. Lou Crone listened to a couple of my tapes, and they hired me on the spot. They said, fine. They said, we got a great deal for you. They were going to pay me $50,000 a year, and listen to this, and $10 a live spot. This is from somebody who's been making $200 a week and 50 cents a live spot. And in one of my less brilliant business moments, when he said $10 a live spot, I said, hell, you're going to pay me $10 a live spot, you don't even need to pay me a salary. Because that was huge money, and I knew that I could generate a lot of sponsors. Now, Neil at the time was doing occasional live spots. Mm-hmm. Live spots were not a big thing.
Right.
When I came down here, my show within 3 weeks, I personally sold it out. We had about 20 sponsors, and people, and I did all of them with live spots, and people started to realize the value of
KAT
the live
KAT was
spots.
The first station to really do a lot of
but they were occasional. They were dressing on the Christmas tree.
Not
when,
a KAT.
When we came down here, I wasn't here at KAT.
No, I'm talking about
but when we came down
80.
Here, everything was so live after I was here for a while. And that was a lot of the rivalry between Neil and I. He used to be upset if I got a sponsor that he didn't get or some, you know, a lot of, Neil was very competitive. I probably was competitive in those days, too.
Great.
So I started the radio wars.
We're totally blaming you for that. This is a good post. We do have breaks, I know.
Believe good, it or no,
right. And we're taking the opportunity to play a lot of long, you know, blast from the blast clips.
Blast from the blast.
I talk for a living. Don't be confused. 12:20, Steve Kane, Craig Worthing, George Rodriguez. Boca Bryan's up there, but we can't for some reason get his audio. Monica, having a big clusterfuck here on SoFloRadio.com. Or not. Maybe you can't hear me. Oh, geez. Yeah? Is he doing stuff? No, he can't hear me. Oh, this is tragic. This is tragic. What a demonstration of our strength and power. And I'm de-balled. I don't even know if Boca Bryan can hear me at this
doing
point
live
right now.
Spot.
No, I think he's got it. There
going
it is.
The radio revolution. SoFloRadio.com. Going with Neil to Las Vegas could be a lucrative deal for you. But if you're not there, the odds will be against you. Vegas in April with Neil. Commercial jumbos out of Miami and Fort Lauderdale. Rooms at the MGM Grand. Tips, transfers, coupons, and the incredible energy of Las Vegas. April 18th through the 21st. Booking now through Regal Travel. 445-7740 or 989-8888 or 1-800-686-1161. Neil's going to Vegas with you at News Talk and Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD.
SoFloRadio.com and SoFloTelevision.com.
When you're ready to actually lose weight safely and steadily while being monitored by a physician, the weight loss clinic of Dr. Kim Jacobson is there for you. The family medicine practice was established by her father in 1956 and continues as a medical practice that now specializes in weight reduction. Dr. Kim Jacobson joined the practice 20 years ago as both a family medicine practitioner and weight loss specialist. The weight loss clinic utilizes a combination of appetite suppression medication and vitamins to produce great results, usually 3 to 4 pounds per week for most patients. Now you can change your lifestyle while still enjoying your own food, just less of it. They offer a choice of 2, 3, or 4 week plans. So whether you just need to lose a few pounds or a lot, the weight loss clinic of Dr. Kim Jacobson can help you. They're located at 5454 Northeast 4th Avenue in Miami, just 2 blocks west of 54th Street and Biscayne Boulevard. Call them at 305-751-0091. They'll be happy to answer any and all of your questions. That's 305-751-0091. Get started on a beautiful new body today with Dr. Kim Jacobson and the weight loss clinic.
Hi, this is the much loved and revered Boca Bryan. My new disc is called Boca Twist Party. You'll get all the songs that were banned after 2005. You'll get. And you'll get. But wait, you'll get. It's my 14 inch long, super hard morning disc boner. Yeah, and you'll get this, too.
You know you make me wanna pull my pants down and...
Invest in your future now. These CDs will be worth a fortune after I'm dead and buried in the Oh Yeah, That Guy mausoleum.
A victim of a debilitating career disease known as Florida. Won't you help?
Boca Bryan's latest release, Boca Twist Party, is available now on SoFloRadio.com.
SoFloRadio.com. Give us a call at 954-99-0036. Mobile users, call 954-990-0036. And for those of you living in the past, call Butterfield 990-0036. Skype name SoFlo Radio.
Miss Naomi Steenstein of Syosset, Long Island, has a problem.
Look at this face. I got more bad lines than a Neil Simon play.
She needs the soothing, moisturizing comfort of new oil of Oy Vey.
Oy Vey!
blended from the finest chicken schmaltz and chopped liver. Oil of Oive is the kosher cleanser designed to soften skin that's mazel tough.
How wonderful! My face feels like every cell just married a dentist with a big breakfast.
So, when your skin's as dry as last year's matzah, don't pass over the blue and white box that makes your skin smell like day-old lox.
Oive!
No, Oil of Oive is real good.
Friday nights, they're two Miami cops with a hot new beat. They're on the streets fighting crime.
Look, pal, we just don't do strip searches for jaywalking.
In Key West Vice.
We got a problem. The Moose Gang is back in town.
Lieutenant, isn't that the group of hairdressers who attack people on the beach, hold them down, and then set their hair?
Yeah, they're back in town.
Let's go get them.
They'll stop at nothing to clean up the streets.
Officers, I'm sorry for skipping in a no-skipping zone. I hope you guys don't get on to me.
Just take a seat, pal.
Gladly.
A chair, a chair.
Yes, Key West Vice.
All right, stop, you pickpocket.
I beg your pardon. I'm not a pickpocket.
Oh, sorry. Just look like...
Yes, there are a couple of hit Miami cops on a hot new beat in Key West Vice. Friday nights at 9 on NBC.
SoFloRadio.com, the George Rodriguez Show, Boca, Brian, Monica, and incredible guests of honor. This is a very historic, monumental occasion. Craig Worthing, Steve Kane, in the studio, in our humble little ghetto studios. How do you like the palatial, I keep telling people, and you can back me up, we have the entire top floor of an apartment building, the penthouse apartment, top floor, the entire top floor
it's
of the apartment building.
It's a neat little setup.
I'll tell you something. I've worked at radio stations that weren't as well-equipped or as nice.
Well, the old FTL was horrible. This
well,
is
that
nice.
Was fair, but you ought to work at the SRF.
Very, very comfortable. This is a dream studio. All of us have ever worked in radio. Remember, think of all of the times that you've had to, like at IOD, we had to run down the hall, down a flight of stairs to go to the bathroom. Because the men's room was downstairs, and the kitchen, the kitchatorium, was downstairs also. Here you got the kitchen right there, three steps away, and the bathroom four steps away. The only thing more convenient is to actually be sitting on the toilet during the radio show.
Neat, clean.
Thank
immaculate.
You. I Cloroxed the entire place because I knew that you were coming over here, Steve. And if you thought that was something, just wait till you leave how I'm going to Clorox the place.
And you're so kind.
I'm going to boil the microphone and burn that chair.
You bring up something. I've got to tell a little quick. It has nothing to do with
take
Neil,
your time
right?
with it. You're here to tell Neil stories.
FTL, all right?
I'm sorry?
When you were the boss
yes.
FTL, all right? You remember the studios.
Was I the best program director you ever had?
Second best, yeah.
Who is better than me?
No, you were excellent. Well, let me tell the story.
You could talk to. And...
So on my show, people would come into the studio frequently and sit around, you know. And the producer was in the beginning in the other room, all right?
I know what story.
And one night I'm doing my show, and someone says, comes up to me during a news break and says, you know, there's a guy in the kitchen masturbating into the sink. What? What? So I ran up to the kitchen. There was a guy up there.
In radio, that's not that unusual. No, this is before the erection injection?
No, it wasn't you, no.
I can see how that would put pressure on you.
I don't know the guy's name, but we used to call him Crazy David. And I said, what the hell are you doing? He said, those two guys in there get me horny. Please go into the men's room, for God's sakes, will you? I said, I've got women in there. I've got people sitting around. And you're masturbating into the sink? Get out of here, you know.
That's the whole story?
Well, yeah, what do you want? I can tell you others.
Yeah, that sounds like a setup to a punchline.
Yeah, that story doesn't have a climax.
That's exactly.
Oh!
Ba-doom bang.
First night in radio. I was a jock and a newsman. You know, you do everything. I went in, and the guy before me was sitting down like George is, and come to find out, his girlfriend was under the table giving him a... blowjob.
Yeah. Okay. We can say that.
First
know.
Night on the radio.
Tell them about the time, just to raise the level a little bit. Tell them about the time that you. Who did you almost punch out, or the time you got angry at somebody and you called me on the
Rick.
Phone?
Oh,
was
just
that it?
Quick, yeah.
Let me just give you a little background on this. When I set up FTL, I based it on confrontation, and I would hire as many liberals. Hard to find liberals. There were almost none out there. Good liberals, good conservatives, and I would put them together. I put you together with, who did I put you with?
Rick Seidem.
Rick Seidem.
What do you mean, keep saying? You were friendly with him at the time, you know.
Yes, I was.
They were very close at the time.
And I was friendly with you at the time.
I'd known Seidem for years because he worked with me at KAT.
Right.
And but he got more and more right wing, and I got more and more left wing.
Craig
and he was
left-wing.
On right before me, and so I try not to listen to him coming in. But once in a while, I'd
unfortunately angry.
Turn on the show, and there he was, really going after Chelsea Clinton at the time.
With truth.
And I'm furious. By the time I hit the station door, I'm going down the hall, and I want to kill him. I really want to kill him. But the door is locked. So I'm pounding on the door, and finally I go into the control room, and I call Steve up, and I'm screaming at you, yelling and screaming at you, and I said, I'm not mad at you, but if I don't take it out on you, I'm going to go in there, and I'm going to punch that son of a bitch right in the mouth. And you know, you think, here's Steve, his best friend at the time, Rick Seidem. You think he'd say, Craig, calm down. Steve's saying, do it!
It would have been great.
He didn't care if I went to jail. He didn't care if I hurt Seidem. He didn't care if I broke the door.
It was all for theater. Now, for example, the time with Greg Budell. Greg Budell worked for me for a period of time, the most aggravating period of time that I had at FTL. And
he's really straightened
he
out.
Was, I'm very well. Pleased, but he sure wasn't straightened out when
I
he
like
was
Greg.
With me. He's a nice guy, but his wife was in the process of, he was a guest on my show at the time. And his guy shows up with a subpoena from his wife trying to serve him for a divorce.
Yeah, okay.
This was
on the air?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, he was on the air.
Right.
The guy just walked through the front office. The receptionist, there's a man here for Mr. Budell. He has a subpoena from his wife to divorce him. So Greg is like panicked. He says, should I run out the back? I said, no, look. I says, this is a break, during a break. I said, you're going to get the subpoena one way or the other. We have a chance to make radio history here. Let him serve you the subpoena on the air.
Wow.
And he says, oh, well, no, I don't want to. I says, just trust me. Trust me, it'll be a great moment in radio. And the guy came in and served him his divorce subpoena on the air, and Greg broke down in tears and collapsed. But it was a unique moment in the history of radio.
And what station was that?
This was the FTL. This was the one where I ran it.
going back to KAT, because we want to do things in a little bit of order before we get to the radio wars. Craig Neal working at KAT. Who left there first? Was it Neal?
Oh, Neal.
Neal, and where did he go from there?
We had the greatest boss that either one of us ever had. You know, Neal will knock his the management, but never Sid Levin.
He's always had good things to say about Sid. Is Sid still alive and around?
I know. I tried to reach him the last couple of weeks to tell him about Neal.
Sure.
Because when Neal was conscious, I wanted to see if I might get together with Sid and go over, but... excuse me. Late 78, he came out and said, no problem. Sid was great, you know. And Neal started off. And then Neil got this offer to go. Gee, I don't know. I thought it was INZ was the next job.
No, WNWS.
Was it NWS?
Yes.
And so, no, I left in early 81, and he was long gone and doing magnificent.
And then what happened to you? You just started sweeping doors?
New owners came into KAT, and I had my greatest year in radio, probably in 1980, but in 81, we had a difference of opinion, and a guy who was my best man, who hired me three times, fired me for the third time, and luckily INZ hired me back to do all nights. And that's when Jerry... the program director of WNWS, who I knew from Boston.
Jerry Williams.
Used to come on my show, and he was the program director of NWS, drunk. Okay, you know, Jerry, get the hell out of here. Then he got let go, and I ended up going to NWS under whoever was program director then, in 82.
NWS, Lou Crone was program.
No. He was general
manager. Al Rantel was program director.
No, Al wasn't program. Anyway, whoever was program director hired me. I'll just tell one quick story, and I'll stop this. Somebody called in one night during Christmas time and told me that Johnny Carson had a phone number to give out to his listeners. He had such a great year. He was a phone number. Call anybody you want. Use the number. I thought, gee, that doesn't sound right. So I called my mother, who was a big Johnny Carson fan. And my mother's, you know, not a nut. And I said, listen, is it true about Johnny? My mother said... I think so. So I went on the air for the next two nights giving out this 1-800 number. Call anybody you want in the world. Well, unfortunately, I was sitting at one of my sponsors, the airport restaurant up here. It's runway 84, and we got a phone call from...
Lou Crone.
I want to see you Monday morning. And they suspended me for 3 months because it was phony, obviously. And... and then the 3 months they fired me, and that's when I couldn't get a job. I was blacklisted for a year and a half. I didn't work.
Yeah. Was that all? Oh, I'm setting a new record. Last year, the first time I ever heard the words "you're fired" in my life. I've always been that guy, even in radio.
No, I was fired a lot.
I've never been fired in my life, and I've also never been not hired for any job that I interviewed for, which is all
weird.
But the industry, very lucky, and times change, and so and here we all are. So tell me about the radio wars, because I've heard a lot. But
radio wars.
Were you two working together at the time?
Off and on.
But you were at Wins when you
had. No. The radio wars started with Neil and I at WNWS. I came down. And I have never been one, you'll relate to this, I've never been one to follow rules. There's an unwritten rule of radio, used to be, traditional radio.
Sure.
This was the golden age, that you don't speak, you don't say anything, mention any other talk show hosts on the air. It had something to do with not wanting to give publicity to some nonsense.
Well, stupid.
I was the one that came in and decided I was going to start attacking my colleagues on the air.
Okay.
And I started with Neil. I was a liberal at the time, which shows you how you evolve.
Yeah, I know that story. That's all right.
I think it started with the Cuban thing. There was some kind of a Cuban influx or something coming in.
Yeah,
and Neil was
we influx.
Yes, and Neil
we're fluxing you right now, as a matter of fact.
Neil did not like the Cuban immigrants at all, and he did show after show. And I came on the air, and I started attacking him. I said, this man is a bigot. What has he got against Cubans? Cubans are nice.
Must be the 80 Mariel.
It was a very liberal point of view. I'm not sure I would have the same point of view today.
You hate Cubans now, do you, motherfucker?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm talking about immigration thing. But it was an immigration thing, but he would attack Cubans.
I think it was Mariel.
And I would attack him. And then I started, we had a lady who worked for us, a crazy lady on the left named Gypsy O'Brien, who was a feminist. Shirley Peters was her name, and then she changed it to Gypsy O'Brien. And one day I had her as a guest on my show. We were doing abortion was a big topic in those days.
Yeah.
And even back when I was a liberal, I was always anti-abortion. I guess it's because I had adopted kids. I have six adopted kids.
Wow.
All adopted
Collect
at birth.
Them all.
All adopted at birth. So it gives you a different view about abortion.
That's why.
And we had a baby... who had an impression in a jar. She was a three-month unborn fetus. And she was passed around the pro-life movement because it made it very vivid. You could see it was really a child. And I don't know what personal experience Shirley Peters had had, but we brought out Baby Precious to show her what an unborn child that she was so blithely recommending aborting looked like. And she got hysterical. She just broke down in the studio and started to sob and obviously, she'd had some experience in her life. Oh, yeah. That
I run around with a coat hanger with a piece of shrimp on the end of it just to show people what abortion looks like. Yeah, I don't care. I'm to advocate the other thing. It's just a piece of shrimp. You know, just yank that thing
right
out of there.
Right, right. Well, none of the ones I adopted came out looking like shrimp. That's neither him
nor... Everybody starts out looking like shrimp, and then, you know, you develop individual characteristics. So what year was that? So that was 80?
This is 83. No, I wasn't here in 80. 83.
Okay.
And then Neil, who... For a while, Neil just took it and didn't respond, and I kept goading him and kept goading him. And finally, he and Al Rantel got together, and they started attacking me, and that was the start of all these personal attacks, which was great listening. It was fun.
Everybody always talks about it. All the radio wars, and they... over the years, because obviously I came on after the radio wars, but people, fans, you know, listeners, they keep saying, oh, but the radio wars, you should revive the radio wars, do more radio wars.
It kept on
people,
through the years.
Your stalkers, your sycophants would always call Neil, try to get something started, try to revive
the
radio wars.
Neil also, don't forget, shortly after that, went after Al with the Alice thing. He's the one who brought Al Rantel out of the closet.
Right,
sure. He hated closeted
Pretty much everybody joined in, and that period was known as the period of the radio wars, with everyone attacking everybody.
Not just on two stations. I mean, we had like four talk stations at one point in this town.
Yeah, WGBS, FTL, IOD, God, INZ, we had more than four.
Well, wherever Neil and I moved, and even when we were together at that brief period at, where was it,
NWS.
They're all blending together.
None of us worked with GBS.
Neil and I always went after each other. Yeah. Neil would do it with cards. I'm amazed you don't have that. You must have that.
It's in here somewhere.
Yeah.
I got it.
But and we hear you now, Booker Brian. Welcome to the show.
Hey, fellas.
It's not you.
Come back.
It was doing the same thing on my end, so don't feel bad, old chap.
Steve, Craig, thanks for coming in, man.
Thank you.
Really nice to meet
you.
Thank
you.
It was, it's definitely what you call it.
Oh,
wait a minute. It was definitely Skype, Booker Brian, so don't feel bad. Let me do
Skype
something.
Skype was down.
Just tell me what your problem is.
I'm a pack rat. Speaking of collectibles, you collect kids.
We
want to
get a copy. We got to get a copy.
Oh, right-click send. It's as easy as that. So give me your flunky's email address over here. Tell you what, because I'm a burnout, just send me an email and I'll respond to it with the cart, and you can play that there. We could start radio wars, but
or any other stuff you've got that you want to send us, we'll be
we'll send you. How about promos for the show? Like
absolutely.
This, we'll make a little promo.
I'm a big believer in that.
Absolutely. Why not? Because we got
one hand washes the other.
One hand whitewashes the other. Well, now that Boca Brian has joined the show, we can take another break, relive some memories, try to get Nick Lawrence. Have you spoken to Nick lately?
I run into him periodically here and there.
Where? At strip club, swing club?
Backroom
poker?
I don't go to those places anymore.
No,
I run into him
clean.
In supermarkets.
Yeah.
Now.
Oh.
I'm born again Christian now.
Oh, are you now?
Yes, I am.
I used to be, and then I got better. Boy, are we some shows we could do?
Oh,
yeah.
Sure.
I got my Bibles right up above your head, behind you.
I would be
on the other side of you.
I'd be very pleased
to be on the Bible quiz
you.
Team.
Yes.
Yeah, no. I'll help you, although something tells me that you're beyond redemption. You know,
probably.
By the way, I don't know if you noticed, I have a Jesus antenna topper. Like people have a golf ball or something on top of their antenna.
Right.
Mine is Jesus.
Yeah.
And I have Jesus Band-Aids right above your head over
clearly
there.
Clearly the Lord has made a big impression.
Yeah, Jesus and I are tight. Me and the Christians, we got problems all the time. 17 till 1 on all Christian radio, SoFloRadio.com.
We're going to let Craig take us out.
We're going to come right back with you on 79 WNWS.
Only one station brings you Steve Daly and Prescott Robinson. Weekday mornings from 5 to 9 on the news station. News Talk 79 WNWS.
They're funky. They're old. They're the California prunes.
Tell them you're getting old and gray. And you're constipated every day. You've had some relief, and that's for sure. And so for you, we got the cure. Just eat some of us, eat us every day. And then flush your crabs away. Don't you know that? they're wrinkled and they're tasty. Man, I'm used to it so tasty. X-Lax is nice, but it don't wake fast. Just eat some prunes, they're real blast. I'm the body, yes.
I'm a body, if you eat us, you're a smarty pants.
California prunes. What a way to go.
More listeners than any sports station anywhere. SoFloRadio.com.
Adventures in time and space. Transcribed in future tense.
The powwow.
Countdown for blastoff. X minus 5, 4, 3, 2, X minus 1.
Disorder never sounded so good.
From the far horizons of the unknown come tales of new dimensions in time and space. These are stories of the future. Adventures in which you'll live in a million could-be years on a thousand maybe worlds. Galaxy Science Fiction Magazine presents...
The Powwow. Weekends at 12. Only on SoFloRadio.com. Jan Michael Morris isn't just any attorney. He's your attorney. The Morris Law Office. Handling your legal needs for more than 20 years. Providing a wide range of legal services for those who need it most. Let Jan Michael Morris put his experience to work for you. Call Jan Michael Morris at his Boca Raton office at 561-395-4195. And speak to Jan Michael Morris directly. That's 561-395-4195. Or visit themorrislawoffice.com.
Spokesperson is not an attorney. SoFloRadio.com. Give us a call at 954-990036. Mobile users call 954-990-0036. And for those of you living in the past, call Butterfield 990-0036. Skype name SoFloRadio.
They bury Billy Brown today.
That's it? Isn't that enough?
Boy. Talk about morbid.
Now, well, Wart wrote that, right?
I don't know.
Who sang it?
I forgot to look at the composer on the bottom of the record.
Wart sang it. Doc Downey. Mm-hmm.
Wart Downey sang that?
That's him. That is him. Mm-hmm.
Boy.
No wonder he's so depressed.
I don't know if you put it or not.
Mm. That's enough to make my warts blanch.
Isn't it unbelievable?
Mm-hmm.
Something.
I thought his show was depressing, but that's ridiculous. Anyway, more and more people are buying car phones these days, and portable phones, too.
God! Oh, my God. Holy something.
And it's really sad to see that some of them are being taken for a real ride.
What happened to your voice?
It was the helium from that breath that just went out, crossed through the atrium, into this studio, and into my throat.
This is the weirdest radio show I've ever been on or heard in my life. I can't imagine what this sounds like.
More and more people are buying car phones these days, and portable phones. And it's really sad to see that some of them are being taken for a real ride, not only by those cheap-talking, fly-by-night, douchebag, mung-brain, lousy, rotten, filthy discount car phone companies. Buy smart. Go mobile with the best. Florida's number one mobile phone company, ABC Cellular. And take it from me. I know ABC is dedicated to customer satisfaction. And those NEC car phones from ABC look like magic in my Corvette and my Ferrari. And when I get them hooked up, they're going to sound good, too.
I went to Nutrisystems. I was thinking about losing weight. I stepped on the scale, and they got a measuring tape. They said, wait a minute, mister, there's only so much we can do. I think liposuction may be the only thing for you. Suck the fat off of my eddy. Suck the cellulite. Suck the weight right on me.
lights. I don't have to worry about no bulges around my thighs. Cause thanks to liposuction, you know I'm a brand new man. Hook up the Hoover, suck the fat out as fast you can. Suck the fat off my baby, suck the cellulite. Suck the fat off my baby.
WNWS. Our contact number, toll free in Dade County, 665-WNWS. We hear you. In Broward, 463-TALK. Call toll free. And in North Broward and South Palm Beach, 426-TALK. WNWS.
Hi, Worthing.
Oh, Al Lopez aboard with you here on News Talk 79 WNWS. We have lines open and available. I'd like to hear from you on this Monday morning.
Wow, that's nice. And by the way, it is Skype. Mine's going on and off, Boca Brian. Never,
you know,
ever.
What I was going through, man. I was like putting my right toe behind my left ear doing cartwheels.
Same thing going on. It keeps graying out. Never since we started this thing have we ever had a problem with Skype. This is a first. I don't know what the hell is up there ass today. It's just because everything's beautiful, you know, because we have these VIP guests in the studio, and we're showing them how really technically apt we are and how slick and how we have everything down. And so, of course, Murphy says, nah, this is the day that everything's going to be fucked up. I'm going to try to get Nick Lawrence on the phone. I was telling Steve before the show, that was off the air, right, that my very first training session, I mean, I've said this on the air before, my very first training session in talk radio, period, my very first day of work was on the Steve Kane show, sitting next to Nick Lawrence. Neil used to make fun of his smell all the time. What is that all about?
Is there
anything to that? Because Nick always smelled like a hibiscus flower.
There were two stages. And all, I mean, I've known Nick for quite a while. And early on.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know what Neil's talking about.
Oh, no, I don't have him here. I'm going to have to punch in his number manually, and I don't even know how to do that on Skype anymore. And if you are out there in radio land, call up 954-99-0003-6. Steve Kane, Craig Worthing here, sharing some old times. Craig, round it out. Bring us back up to date. You said you were out of work for about a year and a half. This was after you got fired from NWS.
From the Johnny Carson thing. And then,
what happened?
I went broke. I really had two little kids, and I called my ex-wife up in Carolina and asked if they'd come up there and do high school.
Uh-huh.
She said yes, and so they went up there. And then a woman who I've, to this day, never run into again, named Dilly Deakle.
Really now?
Who was the program director of Channel 39, called me to come over there and do the all-night show opposite Big Wilson on Channel 6. And so I went over there, and I was scared to death. I'd been out of radio, out of broadcasting for a year and a half. So I went over, and I really was getting into it. You know, the all-night show on old television shows.
This is you were on TV.
Pardon?
This is on TV.
TV, Channel 39. And after 4 months of that, everything got my confidence back. She called me one day and said they just fired me, meaning her, and new management is signing off at midnight. So I was out of work again. And luckily, at that point, that's when Al Rantel, who was program director, this is now late 84, called me to come back, do all nights at NWS, where I went, and I stayed until WJNO called me to come up and do 6 to 9 for a couple of years. And since I was living in Palm Beach County, I went up there and did it, enjoyed it.
Okay, and then?
And then, one day,
then what happened?
They came to me and said that they were replacing me with Michael, gosh, I can't think of his name, good guy, too, you know him. He's now network on out of Seattle.
Savage, Schultz.
No, Michael, you'd know his name.
Michael Motorcycle.
Anyway, they put him in 6 to 9, and they said, you can do all nights. And I said, oh, good, I'll do it. But they said, you've got to sell your show. I said, wait, you want me to work all nights and sell the show? Screw that. So luckily, I called up whoever was program director at WS.
See, that's the problem. That's the interesting thing about talent. Talent, for the most part, usually... George is going to relate to me on this because we're very similar. I always sold my show, no matter where I was back in Orlando with overnights, 50 cents a day. First of all, I could never trust a salesperson to do the job that I could do.
And he always said that about you, that you were an excellent salesman.
He was kind.
Most on-air people... I'm good salespeople.
And I love it. My background.
I can pitch. I can't close. I have to leave the room for that part of it. I would just collapse.
Close.
I want to be able to
pitch with no clothes.
Yeah, whatever.
No money.
No. Tell me about it.
But I always believed in that, and I always was just a little bit, when I would say contemptuous, I'm going to be contemptuous of my friend Craig, but the people that say that used to feel, I'm too good, you know, I'm a star,
right.
I'm too good to lower myself to do something like that, I always had
I'm too bad. I'm just bad at it. I just don't have the ability to ask for anything, money or anything.
It's very unusual in the business to find people who have talent, who are on the air, and have sales ability, too. But when you get that combination, take, for example, what's his name, our good friend at Fox. The guy who's on...
I don't watch Fox.
Glenn Beck. Beck is a master pitchman. Glenn Beck, while he has a huge audience and is paid for his audience... Most of what Glenn is paid for is his ability to sell.
Neil would be throwing up at this point.
I'm kind of gagging a little bit. But I'll tell you something.
He's not saying anything that is true. He's just saying that Glenn Beck is right. Not yet.
I'm not getting into the content. Neil used to do spots, and I'm not going to say anything negative about Neil here at this memorial kind of occasion we're having, but Neil used to do his spots. Neil used to do his spots as though he was contemptuous of the spot. He would go out of his way, whereas I go out of my way to tell you how much I love the product. He would go out of his way to deliver a spot in a way that said, I'm only doing this because they're paying me to do it. Unless it was special. Special food spots and things like that.
Never were as good. I've got to say this. Neil was never as good at doing spots, especially with food spots as you. You're the best with food spots.
He makes a lot of yummy sounds with his mouth.
Peppercorns.
Say steak au poivre just once, Steve.
Steak au poivre.
I'm going to wet my pants over here a little bit.
Delicious. Juicy. Thanks very much.
My Skype is still fucked up. I can't call out. This is a horrible, horrible state of affairs. I had Bob Green. I had Cheryl. I sent Cheryl a message. Jennifer Rem is supposed to be calling up today, Boca Bryan, and here we are not able to take some phone calls.
At least we have Skype. I did move quickly.
Yes, you did.
Okay.
Is that a bathroom joke? Is that something that's going on?
No, that's what Steve used to say. If you move quickly, you could get in soon.
Are we caught up on Craig? Because I don't want to lose this. Because at some point, Craig and Steve show up on the same station, and then
let me tell you that little story.
Yes,
right? My friend over here, my only friend left in broadcasting, other than Al Knight.
Boy,
I ended up going back on FTL daytimes. Excuse me. They tried to do talk daytimes. Neil wasn't there. Steve wasn't there. You were NWS someplace. I don't know where. Anyway, it lasted for a year, and King Paul decided that he couldn't make any money with talk that way, so he dumped talk.
Okay.
Meanwhile, you left wherever you were.
I was in New York.
Are you in New York? And you came back and talked King Paul into putting you on from 3 to 6, I think.
I did kind of what you talked about earlier. I had a list of sponsors who were committed to sign year-long contracts that amounted to about $250,000. And I told King Paul, I said, I'd burnt my bridges at the major stations. And I told King Paul, I said, look, just give me the 3 hours. You don't have to pay me any salary. I'll give you half the revenue. And he did it. And it was so successful that he came to me after a couple months and said, why don't we do this with the whole station? And that led to Craig's next job.
Was when we were on before doing talk daytimes, we didn't have the right setup or the right person in charge until you came along.
And there was no talent there except you.
So anyway, I was out of work while he was doing this 3 to 6 in the afternoon thing.
Mm-hmm.
And coincidentally enough, George, I'm driving down the street one day and listening to Steve. And some woman called in and said, "Oh, Steve, you're wonderful, but I wish you would get Craig Worthing on with you." And Steve...
That was clearly one of Craig's listeners.
Steve, yeah, sure, only the old people. But anyway, Steve went on to say, "Oh, yeah, I like Craig. He's a good friend. I like him. I really do. But no, he doesn't belong in talk radio. He only appeals to the over 100 people."
Oh,
and,
no.
I can never
that's
have...
That's not what I said.
Well, practically, it is. You were nasty. So mean. I shut that goddamn radio off so fast, and I said, "Steve, you son of a bitch."
That is...
It's almost the only time I never thought I'd speak to you again.
That is...
No, you were mean as hell.
Hold on one second.
I know. I was in the car. I don't forget it.
What you have...
Not politics, not religion, just... You thought I didn't belong in talk radio. You said it.
No. Hold on one second. What you just repeated on the air is what you heard. It's not what I said.
Did you say?
I will tell you exactly
what you think
I
heard about a seagull?
I said Craig is great. He has a wonderful way of telling stories and a leisurely way of telling stories. He is part of the old radio. This station is designed for confrontation.
Mm-hmm.
And Craig... His style would not fit into what we're doing here. That's what I said. Did that sound mean, George?
No, that doesn't sound mean. Yeah,
well,
it sounds less mean than what
with grease on his...
Well, it's still saying, you know, he's not right for the station, don't hire the man.
So in December, the program director of the station at that time was... help me.
Well, I'm sorry.
The program director of the new FTL when you took over was...
It was me.
No, the girl.
Dolores was not.
No, Dolores was initially. Initially, she was the program director.
All right.
Because she's the one who called me and said, "I'm the program director of the new FTL.
Right.
And
well.
Steve would like to have you come in and talk to me and talk to him about doing a shift." And I hung up on her. I thought, "I'm not going to go in to see that son of a gun." And she called me twice, and I hung up.
Is that what you really said,
time.
Or did you say son of a bitch?
Probably.
Okay.
Not to her. No, she was very nice.
She
Dolores.
Just thought it.
Dolores
right.
King, very nice. And on the third call, she said, "I'm not going to call you again." I said, "I'll go see him." And ended up doing talk with him. Can you believe that?
He was great.
What was the day part?
He wasn't on the day part.
You wouldn't let him on in the daytime?
That was the point. Where his style did fit into... Yeah, this will make sense to you.
Mm-hmm.
Where his Craig's kind of casual, low-key style did fit into a controversial station was 8 to midnight.
Okay.
And he was next to myself.
That isn't where he started me.
He was close.
He started me 10 to 2.
All right. And then we moved him back. But he was... Craig
was second highest... income maker on the station.
He was always...
And I made nothing, and Al Rantel made a ton, and I made more money than he did.
And
that's how it works.
That's true.
That's how it works.
That's true.
You know the most money I ever made in radio in
how
40
much?
Years.
Was
one year with you, I made $50,000. Al made $150,000 while
much.
I was making $50,000. I averaged about $40,000.
That's how much the bird's starting pay was at IOD, by the way, is $50,000, and all he had to do was laugh at Neil's jokes and eat. And he couldn't handle that,
do
by
you
the way.
A story about the bird?
I'm interested in the bird.
I can tell you all about it, although we did not overlap, and that's a common misconception, is people think that I took the bird's job. Wrong on two counts. He was long gone before I ever sat down across from Neil the first time, and the second count is that Glenn was never Neil's producer. He was there in the studio as a sidekick. He wasn't the producer board op, which is, of course, a completely different thing. Neil would bring producers onto the air with him because in the name of breaking the rules, he didn't want to read little messages.
Right.
He brought everyone into the studio. He talked about carts and formats, and he used the jargon, and the producer had a microphone in front of him, so Neil said, "Use that microphone. Let the audience know what's going on."
Right.
So that's why people think,
and this has nothing to do with you, because I didn't even know who you were at the time, so it wasn't a comparison.
I was small, but I was just another snagger on the other side.
Neil's show better with the bird than Neil by himself, because what the bird did to
in
me...
In the beginning.
What the bird did for me was he brought out a lighter side of Neil's, you know, as a sidekick, the major function is the effect you have on the host, and he lightened Neil up a little bit and took a lot of some of the viciousness.
That's all true.
I told the story previously
because I was there at the time, so we were all talking about what was going on, and you could hear it on the show. And Glenn got more and more of an ego and started having more and more problems with what Neil was doing and throwing tantrums and storming out.
This is one of the few times that Neil called me right after he dumped the bird, right?
Yeah.
And we're sitting in his living room on his couch, which is probably still there. And I said, why did you fire the bird? Because the bird was a big part of his program.
This is good, because other people get
and
to tell
I
this
And I never forgot his answer, and I've used it a couple of times. He took to me and he said, Craig, he was crowding my exit. Meaning, he was coming on too much of the show. He was trying to take over the show.
Right. Yeah. The same problem I have with Brian, the exact same.
I understand how that is. We all have egos. If we didn't have egos, we wouldn't be in this business. We're all hams. We're all clowns. We all fight for the spotlight, or we'd be doing something else.
But the bird was made Neil at his best when the bird didn't say anything. The bird had this thing of sulking.
Mm-hmm.
And
well, that was
then
it.
Neil would play with him to pull, but it was a riot to listen to.
Sure.
To Neil to try to pull him out.
I'd have
and
to play the best
jokes.
Of tapes on the weekend. That was part of my job is playing the best of tapes. And yeah, I could see his role, but then you could also hear it develop as it was going on where you could, because Neil was very honest on the air and off the air. He was obviously having a problem with what Glenn was doing. And when Neil would take days off, Glenn would have all the chronics, like Lurch, you call him Lurch, the guy with
right,
the eyes.
Right, right.
All the people that Neil had banned from the show,
right.
He would give them just carte blanche. He would have them on, he would take a break, put them on hold, take a break, and come back with them, which you know
right.
How Neil hated the chronics. He'd do the opposite of everything that Neil wanted done while Neil was absent and on vacation.
Call it passive aggressive.
And he would storm out of the studio. He would throw tantrums, etc. and so on. And I haven't even started talking about the sexual harassment that Glenn would deal out wholesale. You don't.
No,
see,
no. Tell me.
As a part-time Schmendrick overnight, I talked to a lot of the
sure.
You know.
Well, you were there. You were on the inside of all of it.
Sure. He used his disability as kind of a weapon. He would block women from me being able to walk past him with his crutch. Like he would throw a crutch up against the wall. You know, you understand? Like, and create a rail. So to get the woman to talk to him, and of course, people felt obliged to be nice to him because he walked
sure.
on the crutches and everything. But he was all over every female. If he walked in, you remember that it was a long hallway.
Right.
In WIOD.
Right.
And if he was walking down one end, the women would jump into whatever open doorway they were standing next to until he passed. He would clear the hall of women. I watched him do it on more than one occasion. And, you know, God bless him. You know, he wants to get laid, but that's I could have given him some advice. That's not how you go about
these
it.
Are the, these are the behind-the-scenes stories that most people don't know about.
Well, can I ask you a question before you go?
Oh, God, you sound so stupid.
Wait, we'll take a break. Eventually.
Yeah, go ahead.
Why
I've known
did
a lot
you
of people
me?
That
I didn't
that
call
wheelchairs
you.
Or something, and they would use it.
Can I ask you a question? Do you do live spots now?
We have the ability, but I don't.
Right,
we do recorded.
Right.
My voice is on a lot of the recorded spots. I just
right.
I don't want to stop and read. I'm not as good of a reader as Neil is, as you are. You know, after the third or fourth time, you get good at it. But I just didn't like it. I wanted to have good produced spots. But, we have the ability.
No.
Oh, I'll do it. I'll do it. Well, not anything for money.
Well, you can.
I want to stay on the straight side.
Professionally, though, you can charge more if you use your real
the live thing.
That's the advantage.
Certainly. Certainly. We explore all the angles, and we're going to explore some commercial breaks here. And I'm just really, I'm going to vomit on the table that the Skype is on and off today. 107 on Skype Sucks Radio, SoFloRadio.com.
Greg, yeah.
Greg who?
You know Greg who.
Oh, Greg. I thought you meant Craig.
Greg. Said something about 2A.
Oh, I thought you meant Craig Worthing. We don't like to knock on this show. We don't want to talk about 2A or any other place. We got something positive to say. Go ahead, and we can talk about the Red Sox. They won 11 games in a row. The Red Sox are going to do it this year. They're going to be in this series, friends. And I'm going to go to Fenway and stand outside the ballpark because I haven't got enough money to buy a ticket. You don't know what it's like, friends, to drive around McDonald's and not be able to buy a Big Mac. Oh, that Craig, I'm telling you. It's 9:13 on Zeta 4. It's been a wild 12 years in this market, boy. It's been really something. But, of course, all good things must come to an end.
Hi, this is G. Gordon Liddy, and they don't come any worse than Neil Rogers.
This is your brain. This is your brain on drugs. This is your brain being chopped to bits by a finely honed meat cleaver. This is your brain in a blender. And this is your brain being stirred into a big pot of chili. Brains. Real food for real people.
Hi, this is Ron McGill from Miami Metro Zoo. And I listen to that Neil Rogers 1 to 2 hour. Hell, it's even better than Sex with the Animals.
Coming this Christmas from Bogus Industries. It's the I Can Drive Like Rick Sanchez board game. It's a real-life action-adventure game that uses the streets of South Florida as a game board. Start begins at concession stand A of Joe Robbie Stadium, where each contestant has to drink himself to oblivion. Whoever gets the highest blood alcohol level first rolls on to level number two.
Give me a drink.
The run down a pedestrian and the haul ass home section of the game. This leaves board game police baffled, and each player must come up with a different excuse to go home and get his license. Then it's off to the final leg of the board game. Hire an attorney, go to court, and whoever gets off with the easiest sentence wins. It's hours of fun for the whole family. The I Can Drive Like Rick Sanchez board game. Bogus Industries.
One to the mall, go spend it all. Oh, it's quite oak, you're going broke. Run to the mall, go spend it all. Oh, it's quite oak, you're going broke. Let's fight the stinking traffic. The mobs of people are quite horrific. Let's find a parking space here, although the chances are quite terrific. Merry, 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 merry Christmas. Merry, 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 merry Christmas. Run to the mall, go spend it all. Oh, it's quite oak, you're going broke. Run to the mall, go spend it all. Oh, it's quite oak, you're going broke.
Karaoke. It's the sing-along sensation in bars everywhere. And now there's Harry Karaoke.
Sing along. No.
That's right. Sing lousy and you kill yourself. Harry Karaoke. Choose from the Harry Karaoke songbook, including Cuts Like a Knife and The First Cut is the Deepest.
Just take those old records off the shelf. I sit and listen to them by myself.
It's your choice. On-key renditions of pop tunes or Cold Steel piercing your gut and death with dishonor. Harry Karaoke.
It's the 1 to 2 hour.
Miami has gone Shula, an asshole all the way.
You jackass.
But then there's Sister Mandich, and I'm afraid to say he's gay.
Yes.
He takes that crap from Shula, and he passes it out at night.
You turd.
Dog is back, singing more duets on Mandage Sings, Volume 2.
Yes!
Old number 88 is back, pairing off with the greats, singing more big hits with even more big stars. The Mad Dog does them all. An all-new British invasion with the Mad Dog singing like a man.
I like it. I like it.
The truth is finally out that Jim Mandich was truly the fifth Beatle.
You gotta give me little lovin', give me little lovin'.
Oh!
If you want up to last, and now you're here to stay.
Hear the Mad Dog's tender and touching tribute to the king, Elvis.
All right! All right!
Was just a little ambivalent when we asked him if he wanted to do it again.
Nah,
I don't think so.
So we had Luca Brasi pay him a little visit and tell him either his brains or his signature would wind up on the contract.
That son of a bitch was huge.
Volume 2, available now if you move quickly.
SoFloRadio.com, George Rodriguez, Boca, Brian, Monica, and, of course, our guest of honor today, Craig Worthing, and, of course, Steve Kane, too, also a little bit. So we were working together,
hold on, you got schmutz over Steve's face on the camera.
I got
there.
Schmutz? It's him. It's his face. I can't do anything about that. He's got this kind of a growth on his face.
Sorry. He's old. What the hell?
We can move the camera. Make sure that that people can see.
Where
Steve's
is the camera?
Pretty punim right over there. It looks like an eyeball. Look, it's moving right now.
See,
smiling.
Okay.
You're on the web, live. As a matter of fact, I can show you. That's something that will work. While I'm still working on my Skype thing over here. I'm going to show this to Craig because he doesn't know what this looks like.
Oh, while you're doing that, I want to remind them. Only two guys left in South Florida who remember who this is.
Talk 79 WNWS. Bob Groves with you this evening until 8 o'clock. Craig Worthing will be following me from 8 until midnight. Jerry Wichner from midnight until 5.
We have to listen to it now.
Let me remind you, while I have a second here, that this coming Tuesday...
That reminds me of you doing your television show.
What? That's the end of it? I was hoping for more.
Well, that was Bob Groves.
And Skype is completely ungapachki today.
Nobody remembers that.
So you wound up working together at, I'm talking about the history of Craig Worthing, at
FTL.
At FTL with Steve, and everything was great, and you lived happily ever after, and had a successful radio.
It was great until Paxson came in.
Well, we had good years, and then Lou Crone sold the station out from under us.
Yeah, right.
Paxson was the first problem.
I was fortunate I had a small piece of the station.
Yeah.
But other than that,
this is what you look like.
It was beginning of the
end. Wave. A little bit of a delay, but there it is.
Okay.
You see? And everybody's watching us live. And it'll be recorded. Immediately after the show, you can watch it on demand. People play, pause, rewind, whatever you want to do. A lot of people masturbate to recordings of the show afterwards. I can only imagine they're going to have to put Visqueen over their computer screens today for all this talent in the studio.
David. masturbate to a talk
overnight
show?
I found out that that's something that just went on routinely during the overnights. We had a studio, our own studios.
Masturbate to anything.
At QAM, they gave us our own studios. Neil had his own studio and side studio. I had my own room. He had his own room. But they wanted to use it as an overnight production room. And the overnight guys would say, you got cable with everything in there. You know what goes on in there at night. And I said, don't even tell me, because I know what went on at WIOD. We had cable with everything, including the Playboy channel and everything overnight. So it was like a masturbation station for a lot of the people, that control room, and that was my room. So I would go in there and I would sanitize. People wondered, it's like, what, are you a neat freak? Are you a clean freak? You wipe everything down before you start your workday, before you even put your briefcase down on the counter. You wipe everything down. What's going on there? It's like, 'cause I don't know what's on any of this stuff. I don't know what's on any of this equipment, but I have a pretty good
Better
idea.
Safe than sorry.
No question. Go ahead. Continue with the history of WFTL.
Go ahead.
Paxson
we
destroyed
had great
everything.
Times. The original, the first, 6-7 years before Paxson took over. I must just tell another story since you just brought this up.
Dude, lots of stories. That's what we're here for, especially since our phone guests won't be able to join us today. It's all you two.
Steve gave too many rules. He talked about not liking rules. Oh, please. First of all,
we had no rules.
You'll shut up and let me tell them?
Yeah, Steve.
One of the rules was he had a list of about 14 people who were not allowed to go on the air. Allowed to go. You remember that list?
No. You're talking about the band list.
The band list.
Yes, who was on the band
list? I agree with that.
Who was on it. There was about 14 on there.
I agree with that. My band list has like 20.
Used to say, Craig, what are we going to do? I said, ignore the list. We put everybody on. Everybody gets on, no matter what Steve says.
There are people who live in dumpsters, and they live to be a chronic on your show.
We talk to them. And the second thing was, nobody was allowed to smoke.
So that's one rule.
Oh, and
smoking is two rules.
I was a heavy smoker back then. Yeah. I smoked a pack or two just on my show. So this one particular night, Going back to the when we all had the you and I had the sponsor the erection injection.
Yes,
I really did. I really did.
I still have it. I still do sponsor the erection.
I know, but different outfit. But back then, I didn't need the erection injection, so I had all these needles.
But now you
right?
do. Is that
so? I had a friend of mine who was a dancer at
Crazy Horse.
One of the gay places down here.
I can't help you,
Johnny.
Somebody
anyway,
else.
So he said, "Would it help me?" We were talking. This boy, I wasn't on the air, and I said, "Sure." He says, "Well, we're not allowed, you know, to show any of our parts." He said, "But if we can show how it looks like with our bikini briefs on,
right.
it'll help us on tips."
Right.
And he averaged about $100 a night on tips.
The pun on tips. Yeah,
so
yeah.
He would come in. He had to be like at the show over 11 o'clock right. over at, we'll say, Johnny's. I can't think of the other one. And so during a news break, he'd come over. I'd be sitting here, and I would
You sure you want
shot.
To tell this story on the air?
Right. I'd give him a shot of the erection injection.
Okay.
And he, by the time he got to the club, he would be enormous.
Right.
And the three nights that I shot him up.
Tips with you.
The three nights I shot him up, he made $450, and $500 in tips. Really did well.
You call that a penis?
I was making so much money from you.
That's right.
Well, I got to tell you another little story about Steve. Good old friend Steve who.
Okay.
No, put
they don't hear
there.
You tell stories about
the
me.
Old people,
about me.
Before they
this
go to
excellent.
Bed at night,
gold.
They can listen in, even though he's bringing in more money than Al Rantel. And
that still bothers you, doesn't it?
Sure it does. He was making $150,000.
Oy. Well, that's what he would. That was his
I was
market
making
price.
$45,000 and $50,000.
When Al joined us, he brought with him his
he
salary.
Brought with him, all right.
His salary, like my salary, was figured on the sponsors that came with him.
Right,
and he brought hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of sponsors.
Where do they keep the crack?
To this little 1,000-watt station.
Yeah, right.
The crack?
Right.
Sorry, I have to order that.
Please.
That's what the megaphone is for. You just shout out the window. They bring
Al
the crack right to you.
Al was on midday. He was on midday.
I know what he was on.
And
he followed you.
He had hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of spots.
How much did Joyce make? Did she make more than me?
Oy.
Joyce.
I just saw her on TV the other night.
Last
night, as a matter of fact.
I can, if that makes
she
you feel
fat.
Better.
I had to be the lowest paid. I bet that schmuck before me got more. I'm not talking about Frank.
Which schmuck?
The one who I didn't care for. Danny Dennis. Who was the guy on before me?
Danny
In
Dennis?
In the beginning. I didn't care.
You're not talking about the guy with the tattoos.
No.
The
he
Nazi.
Was a good guy. He was a good guy.
Oh, the Nazi was a good guy.
No. Jeff. No. Who was the guy who came on after Al Rantel?
You talking about Gary Daniels?
Gary Daniels.
Yeah.
Did he make more money than
no.
I did?
You made next... What? Brian, you're a troublemaker.
Brian probably made more money than I did.
Oh, hey, wait, hold on. Can I help you here? Let me explain.
I know.
This
you.
When Brian,
I had a family, for God's sake.
Me too.
You too, right?
We paid Gary a higher salary, but you made more money than Gary Daniels with your talent.
How much do you think I got on bonuses for doing all those live spots, 28 an hour?
You were making like $50,000 a year. It was
you
the best.
Know something. The sales manager would come to me, that pompous Joe schmuck that he was, and say, "Craig, listen, I got a great interview for you. I got Joe Heinrich at his automobiles up here. Name Hendrick, whatever the one was, his automobile dealership." I said, "Why the hell do I want the head of an automobile dealership?" "Oh, he's great. You'll do an interview with him."
Uh-huh.
I said, "Oh, he's buying time on my show?" "No, he's buying time on Steve's show." Wait a minute.
Let him finish.
He's
I got one.
Time
I got a story.
Steve's show, and he wants the interview on my show.
It wasn't a daytime interview.
Don't you think that Steve should do the interview? Well, Steve doesn't want to do it, doesn't fit his program.
There you have it.
Is he buying time on my show, too? No, but I'll slip you 50
That's
bucks.
That's why you would hear.
Slip me 50 bucks. Stick it up your ass.
Let me pull
this three
I got
times
one.
On me.
This is
never
you'll take vacation. This is like for 10 years. I'm doing the entire summer every day that he takes off. Neil's taking vacation. I'm getting not even a fraction of what he gets. And I've got a few of my own live spots, as you know. Sales guy comes in and goes, "Oh, Neil's on vacation. Would you do the blankety blank?
They got you to do this.
Would
stuff.
You
Neil
would you read the spot?
There.
Would you read the spot while Neil's on vacation?" I'm like, "Yeah, how much?" I'm like, "Cause my talent fee is I get $25 to read a live spot.
I got
$25 and like."
No. It's a hell of a talent fee.
No. And I would say, then why on earth would I read the spot? You know, to be nice, to be cool. I'm like, you showed up to work here today to be nice, to be cool? Are you doing something for free in this building that I don't know about? Because I showed up here to make money, not to be nice, not to be cool. They're like, oh, well, maybe, why don't you talk to Neil and see if Neil will share the talent fee with you? Because Neil gets paid the talent fee, right, whether or not you read the spot, or whether or not the spot airs, because that was in his contract.
Did you ever discuss it with Neil?
Huh?
Did you ever have a conversation
with Neil? No, I don't ask Neil for money. I asked Neil for a $600 loan once. I paid him back $200. When I tried to pay him back the other two, like I was going to make installments, he said, forget about it. Like the next, he said, forget about it. I said, I don't ask Neil for money. I'm not a beggar.
Oh, no. It wasn't the money. Did you discuss the issue with him?
I did discuss the issue with him.
How did that go?
And he said, as far as I'm concerned, you can get your talent fee when you read the spots for me. But it really wasn't up to him because Neil didn't manipulate sales contracts. He had no problem with me getting
a lot of paperwork, a
portion of that. But no, it isn't thought a lot. Boy, I'll talk about the chutzpah. They come in and they want me to do a lot of things for free that no one else, no other host, no other, you know, they couldn't get the $5 an hour production monkey to cut a spot for free. But somehow they want me to do that.
George, let me ask you a question.
Ask me a question.
I'm going to use you as a fair and impartial judge.
Okay.
Here is a man, Craig Worthing. You've been in the radio business how many years?
100.
I was in 40 years.
40 years in the
part time and full time.
He has come here today to share his story with the world of his radio career.
Right. Imminently
great. He tells you the most money he ever made in 40 years on the radio when he worked for me at WFT. Did he say that?
I think he said that. I heard that.
And now he's complaining and whining that we didn't pay him enough.
Sounds like my wife.
First of all, not good enough. $1 a spot, and that's only when the money was collected.
What are you talking about? What are you talking about?
$1 for doing live spots. $1.
$1 a holler.
I don't give a shit.
You can say shit all the time.
So what are you telling me? We paid you $50,000 salary?
Please don't.
No, that was part of the salary. I had 28 spots an hour. What did we pay you? I didn't have time to do the show. I was doing the spots all the time.
The spots were the show.
You went too long in the spots. You do 3-4 minutes. I said, that's why they're with me, for God's sake.
That's correct.
Speaking of spots, we got some, and I think my phone came back. We'll see if it's still working after the break. Get Nick Lawrence on and all these other people I promised that we'd talk about. 126 on Maybe It's Working Now, SoFloRadio.com.
Craig Worthing along with you here on News Talk 79, WNWS. Let me slip the glasses on here so I can tell you about Shirley Peters program today, A Voice to Revitalize, on the Shirley Peters Show, today from noon until 3 on News Talk 79 WNWS.
When anyone says news, they're saying our name, W News.
SoFloRadio.com. We take comedy seriously. SoFloRadio.com.
This is Learning to Spell with Donnell. I be Donnell Jackson, and today we're going to spell the word eyes. Spell it with me now. Eyes. E-Y-E-S. Now, let's use it in a sentence. I'm so glad I still got me a job. This is Learning to Spell with Donnell. Yeah, and I'll be Donnell Jackson.
We have such sights to show you.
SoFloRadio.com.
You're coming back? Oh, no. Good. Freak me out.
Some women need a little help to make their shape look somewhat svelte. They used to try a bustier, but now they can go out and pay for Wonder Bra.
Wonder Bra.
Wonder Bra.
Visited our hero, Wonder Bra, was trying to save his beloved Pure Poly Sweetbreads from the clutches of the evil Simon Bar Cleavage.
Wonder Bra!
Wonder Bra can't help you now, Pure Poly Sweetbreads. Simon says, say to your
I'm totally lacking in support. Help!
Wonder Bra!
The situation's bleak. Poor Polly, don't pout. Wonder Bra's here to make them stick out.
Wonder Bra, my hero.
Oh, drats! Foiled again! But I'll be back, Wonder Bra!
Stop him, Wonder Bra! He's getting away!
Stop crying, Polly. Though the villain is jerky, your bust line is back, and your hooters are perky.
So now the world is safe for boobs that want to plump up and protrude. When cleavage is a must to show, there's only one place you can go to. Wonder Bra!
Wonder Bra! Wonder Bra!
SoFloRadio.com. We take comedy seriously. SoFloRadio.com.
Buy the best custom full-color balloons with your photo, logo, or design that will blow your next party or event away with PhotoBalloonStore.com. Take a look for yourself and see why PhotoBalloonStore.com is the place for full-color, custom-printed photo balloons. Our balloons are not made out of rubber, latex, or mylar. They're made from a durable aluminum foil composite film that keeps them inflated longer than any other balloon sold. 11 inches in diameter, uninflated, 9.5 inches inflated. These balloons can be reinflated over and over again. Cheer on your Miami Heat basketball team at home or the arena with our version of the Miami Heat Dream Team balloon. These limited edition memorabilia balloons are available for only $6.95 for a limited time. Visit PhotoBalloonStore.com for more. Order yours today. We deliver on time and fast. PhotoBalloonStore.com.
Bring spice to your life with AfterglowParties.com and tickle your fancy with an assortment of pleasure objects and toys, lotions and lubes, massage products, games, candles, and the highly sought-after vibrating sponge. Plus, so much more. Spice up your bridal shower, birthday party, or just a girl's night out. Let our experienced glow girls show you how with an afterglow party. Much like a Tupperware party in the privacy of your own home. You'll have a lot of fun trying out the items, and our glow girl will explain how to use them. If you want an afterglow party of your own, or just want to place an order, call 305-408-1116. Or go to AfterglowParties.com. Ladies, you haven't lived until you've experienced your very own vibrating sponge. That's 305-408-1116. Or go to AfterglowParties.com. We'll never tell.
SoFloRadio.com. Give us a call at 954-990-0036. Skype name SoFloRadio. Mobile users call 954-990-0036.
Once 133, SoFloRadio.com. And we're back, and the Skype thing still isn't working. I got apology emails to write to people, but that's okay. We're having fun.
Am I still on over there?
You're still going on. I don't understand, but I can't. I can't call out. And it's showing me the same thing that you were describing when you couldn't connect. Now it's happening to me, and it's
grayed out.
And I dare say it's probably happening all over the place. I restarted twice. It's not. I can't even blame the computer this time. What are you eating, Boca Brian?
I'm eating on the air.
Well, we got nothing here.
And I wanted to get Gary Bruce and Cheryl and Bob Green and Jennifer Ramos.
Would recognize this. These are black bottom sandwiches.
What? Black bottom sandwiches? I don't understand. You got to explain it to me. He said that you'd understand
a
what
black
that is.
Bottom sandwich?
Yeah, Boca Brian jokes, you got to Google them later. They're hysterical, but it takes some research.
I've never heard of a black bottom sandwich, have I?
Oh, yes, you did. Remember when you went to Illinois with Larry?
Oh, yeah, but I don't know. Black bottom sandwich? I don't remember the sandwich. We had a great time on that, Boca Brian.
He's made it for you. It was chocolate on bread.
Oh God.
Chocolate on bread. Ooh.
That sounds terrible.
Oh, hey, Brian, we were talking, you know, Steve, what's the song, and it might be a Guitar Man song or something else that mentions the erection injection. And the audience, we need your help on this, too. There's a line, I gave myself an erection injection, blah, 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 thus goes the bit, and I can't think of the name of it, but I know
we
have
the title.
Pardon? Yeah, I know we need the title. This is why I need some help from you and or the audience.
Remember the song? Is it based on a tune?
So I gave myself an erection. I don't know. I mean, we've got some erection songs.
You're singing like George Burns here.
This has nothing to do with Steve.
It's erection time. I'm going to kick off my shoes, strip off my dress.
You get the idea there. And then I also have this one.
I had some.
That's you.
Real hard one.
But I don't think that's. I think it's a Guitar Man song. Are you in touch with him? Is he able to, can you call him?
He has not called me back, that cranky guy.
That bastard.
He's still cranky because he never got his $25 check.
From you?
No, from WIOD. That's
why is he holding that out over our heads? I had nothing to do with that. As a matter of fact, I'm responsible for every dime you guys ever got from any radio station. We were talking about the phenomenon earlier, because we were talking about you, Boca Brian, before the show, and how listeners would just send bits in, and you were one such person, and I was the one that campaigned to actually pay these people, the good ones, Boca Brian, so that they would keep doing it and do a good job of it. And I said, if we pay them, you know, that gives me the ability to say, can you do something like this? And can you tweak that? And it'll actually allow me as the producer to order bits and to get some customization and some influence over these assholes. I mean, these really nice people. And,
I don't know if Steve remembers, but back in WNWS, I was Ronnie Baby.
Ronnie Baby.
Mm-hmm.
Like from the Ronettes?
It's not ringing a bell, but that
He's the president at the time was Reagan.
The Alzheimer's and the erection injections. He's
exactly right.
He's like an old burnout over here.
Don't laugh. You guys, if you're lucky, you'll get old, too.
I'm working on it. I got my white hair and my bald spot, a few skin tags. I'm not looking as weathered as you are.
Let me tell you, I'm hornier today than when I was 40.
Really? That makes sense. It's been that long since you got laid?
I'm regular. May not be as hard as it once was, but...
That's okay. I told Steve. Steve was trying to sell me the erection injection. I said, I don't go for 4 hours. I just go long enough to get.
I'm not here.
Right. Hey, Monica, how you doing?
Okay, I'm not here.
What's up? Cool blue ocean.
And Monica,
cool blue ocean.
Too. Hey, wait, Craig, I have this with you and Larry. I'll play it in its entirety later, but here's
a teaser. And you said, I don't understand this.
They
have them at every Dunkin' Donuts in the United States. And then
every
she said, you know, now that you mention this,
Larry Kent.
I think we once had them here and we discontinued them. And you said, why? And she says, because they never sold.
Well, I want you to carry them. I may be back here in a year or so, and God bless it, I want them here.
I don't think I said God bless either. That woman is the one you told that she ought to take her clothes off and go out.
I had moved. That's true, I did. And she said, no, I.
God, what is this segment?
This guy, Larry Kent, took me on a trip.
We got to quit having so much fun.
Wow. By the way, Joe Castello in the house, ladies and gentlemen. In a Santa Claus suit.
Hey, Joe! Everybody!
Because we're on camera. Do you know Steve Kane, Joe Castello? Have you ever actually met Steve Kane? Come over here and meet the great Steve Kane. And the even greater Craig Worthing. Craig used to work with Neil on WKAT, as a matter of fact. Joe knows all about it. Joe's been listening to Neil since he was in a crib.
Speak, Joe!
Strolling on around, the famous Joe Castello, one of our cohorts here on our online broadcasting outfit. We'll rotate around. Joe's cool. Joe knows the score over here. Skype not working for the first time in history. And I had Bob Green going to be calling in and Jennifer Rem, and I was going to call Nick Lawrence. Nick, that's got me bent out of shape. Bob and Cheryl and Jennifer Rem, we can do some other time, but I really wanted to get Nick on while Steve is here.
You have Nick's number.
I have Nick's number, but I can't, I can put him on speakerphone. How cheeseball would that be? That's the first time we've ever done that. Actually, why don't I do that? I'm very distressed by the whole thing.
Not a bad idea, actually.
All the days, those silly Brits.
Of all the days. And it is. It's a British kind of a company thing. I'll just call him right back. Nick Lawrence. He'll say rock and roll. Nick was the coolest.
Nick was the greatest.
Even tempers.
I have to be careful. I have to be careful talking about Nick because Brian gets sensitive. Nick was my producer. I've been very fortunate to produce. I had Nick, and then I went right from Nick to Brian, and Brian's
much better.
Every now and then.
Much better.
Brian's better. Does he smell better? Because Neil just used to say Nick that all okay, the all the time.
Brian's
Neil
spoiled it.
Hey, all right, now you're on speakerphone, and because I can't get through on the show line to you, but I'm here with Steve and Craig Worthing.
Hey, Nicholas.
And it's the great Nick Lawrence, ladies and gentlemen. Steve said hi.
How's everything going, guys?
Hi, Nick.
We miss you. Where are you now?
Where am I? I'm on the road. I'm in Doral.
In Doral?
How's that? Yeah, keep talking, Nick. You're live on the air.
All right. I don't hear anything on my end, so... What's the news with Neil? Because I didn't know he was even sick.
He's not well, and he's getting less well, and so we're doing a a big vigil.
All right. Where is he? Is he in Montreal?
No, he's down here in Florida in an undisclosed location.
All right. And
he's under hospice care.
I mean, that's terrible. Terrible.
Yes, it is.
I don't know what to ask. I mean, I worked with Neil for... maybe 5 years, more or less. I can't keep track of the time. But when I worked with Neil, he was the top of his game. He was kicking program directors' butts and taking names and just having a great old time back at the old 610 WIOD days.
We already told lots of stories about you.
I worked with him.
I had to remind Steve, he doesn't remember. Probably you don't either. My very first training day in that building was with you on Steve's show. The first time I sat down.
That was the time when there used to be... in the morning, there was Mike Ranieri.
Yes.
And then after Mike Ranieri was
Neil. No. After Mike Ranieri was Neil, and then Steve was in the afternoon.
Oh, really?
Trust me.
Well, there was somebody between Ranieri and me.
But then Neil was
in
midday. Steve would come on after that. Yeah,
right.
Okay.
Steve was on it, too.
And then, those days was Neil was... just basically getting his library put together. The bird was still around.
Yep.
So the bird had departed halfway through the time I was there. But Neil was getting his comedy bits put together with Boca Brian, I think the guy was. And a bunch of other people.
Brian's here with us too.
At the time when I was working with him, he was always like, I'm out the door, I'm going to leave, I'm going to quit. But they kept paying him these huge checks. So he wouldn't quit,
This Neil you're talking about?
Yeah, one time I was talking with Tom Chica, and Tom Chica told me that basically every week they would give him a check equivalent to buying a brand new, Hyundai or a Toyota or something. The checks were huge, so he wasn't going anywhere, And up until the time that I guess, Gary Bruce days and the people after Gary Bruce, then it just kind of got untenable, Back when Steve left and went to New York, that's when Rico Sutz came in.
I
don't think he really liked them all that much. And then after Rico Sutz, there was this other guy, Phil Hendry.
Right.
So, I mean, they were really top and talented.
We had Phil on Monday, by the way.
English talk, you know, but those days are gone. They're not coming back, you know?
Damn it. Well, it's going on over here. We're doing the online thing. That's where it's going on. Ain't coming back to radio. It's not coming back to radio, but we're doing it over here online, man. We're kicking ass.
Yeah. I mean, that's great. I mean, I know that your show is on, and I'm sure it's getting good response, because bottom line, it's a wasteland out here for Anglo talk, so you got to basically go to where the people are. Like, I do programming on the Internet because, you know, from my demographics, there are more people who will click on a show on the online, you know, tune into a show that's got some time on television, you know, so the Internet's the future, everybody knows that, and as long as you put in a good quality product, you should be able to get sponsors, you know, I know Neil didn't want to do it because he was tired out, but if the times were correct and he was young enough, I'm sure he would have done online programming also.
We talked about it, but yeah, he didn't want to work anymore, that's a fact.
Right, because he retired out. But let's say it had been 20 years. Let's say it was in the mid-80s.
Yeah.
And this situation was going on. He would have done online, not like anybody
sure.
else.
No,
you know?
No FCC. Absolute freedom on here.
He would have loved that.
Sorry?
I said there's no FCC. We can do and say whatever we want on here. You know, not slander, but we can say shit.
You said the program, anybody can just re-listen to it anytime they want. So it's
sure.
great, you know? It's good for the advertisers.
Demand.
They get double hits, double clicks, whatever it is.
Right.
It's always good, you know? And I'm, you know, terrible about Neil. I mean, I don't know who's. He didn't have much family at anymore. Right?
His
mom
all gone. His brother is gone. His brother's gone too.
Yeah. So, like, I mean, I don't know. I mean, he's just basically, you know, moving on to, I guess, a better place. Man. Hopefully, you know. I don't know. I know he was not always that religious.
No, not at all.
Hopefully he goes on to a better place, and hopefully he's not in pain, you know, because, you know, you don't want to spend your last days in pain, so hopefully, you know, whatever happens is, you know, humane, you know?
He'll live forever on tape.
You know?
He'll live forever on tape, or, well, we're old radio people, we still say tape. Live forever
yeah,
on,
I did a bad thing one day. I moved around a lot, and I had reel-to-reel. It's like I'm a dinosaur, you know, I got gray hair, I was terrible. I had reel-to-reel tapes of the old shows I used to run in the old days, and I said, oh, these tapes are getting in the way. I threw them away, but
no.
I keep myself forever for doing that, but, you know. As long as you got them on digital archive after that, they'll be around forever.
Right on.
Well, we still have all your old television shows that you did. You left them with us. You didn't throw them out.
All your old TV shows, Steve's talking about.
The Steve Kane show that he was...
Yeah, I mean, normally they are on forever. I know that if you go on to a search for Neil, you will see... I saw one piece of footage one time when he did that old Whammy show. So I know that's off on the internet somewhere. I saw it one time, back when he was sitting in the cubicle and talking to himself on television. But those are the I guess the old glory days.
Yeah. What are you doing now? You said you're programming online. What are you putting on there?
Basically, what I do is I have a number of different television programs that I take care of or produce or have to, I produce to them.
Do they all involve beautiful naked women?
On broadcast, like cable, or they run on the satellite, and then we log them onto YouTube. Some of them go onto YouTube, some of them don't, and yeah, that's what I do. I do television programming. You know, basically I use YouTube, Facebook, Dish Network is a company I work with a lot of times for video on demand. I'm doing the same thing, except I just do television.
Right.
Yeah, gotta work, man.
Absolutely. Well, I had to get you on speakerphone. For some reason, our Skype isn't working today, but I wanted to get you on here while Steve and Craig and all these people are here. Just try to get the cluster all in one place that used to be there when I walked into IOD. Well, Craig wasn't there, but, you know, but he brought Steve. That's his role in all of this.
That was like my farewell spring when I was giving the training grind, because I don't know what I was doing at that time, but I know I wasn't going to be around much longer.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to train somebody really quick. Boy, Gary, like, you got to train somebody quick, Nick. And then you walked in and said, okay, here you go, George, this is how it goes.
Nick was the coolest guy, which was an inspiration, because the talk radio thing seemed at first very hectic. Everybody, there seemed to be a lot of things to do.
It really was, you know?
Right.
And like I told Steve, and I told the guys back at the old FTL days, be happy if you're having a good time, not because one day it's going to be gone.
Right.
Today's gone.
Sure enough. But you were an inspiration. You were always very cool. You just sit back and go rock and roll, and nothing rattled Nick Lawrence, man.
Everything's okay, man. One day I'll come by the studio, and we'll see how you do your thing.
Absolutely. Love to show you. It's pretty fascinating. We might have something to share, to teach each other.
Sounds good, man.
All right. Nick Lawrence, ladies and gentlemen, take it easy. Blast from the past. My first trainer, the first guy that taught me how to run talk shows. Not that he was the only one. I trained under a few other people. By the way, I should have asked him. There was a guy named Eric with a really deep voice. Eric Martinez, I think, also trained me. He went on to do really deep voiceovers. So good. Now I feel now I don't have to worry about the Skype too much. I can just send a little email to Jennifer Rand and Bob Green, Boca Brian, and tell them, hey, sorry, our phone system isn't working today. Try to get them on Monday. How's that?
I wanted to thank Nick and Steve and Rick Seidemann for lunch at Christopher's in 1985. Thank you very much for that.
Oh, they actually bought you lunch? You mean you got a free meal out of these deadbeats?
I got free food.
Okay.
I think Steve was driving his Cressida at the time.
Steve went to the bathroom, and Alan Michaels just walked in.
Yeah.
By the way, and I didn't say this, but Steve, all the while that he was talking to me, we were talking for about 45 minutes when Steve showed up here today, and all the while, he thought that I was Alan.
Happens all the time.
It happens all the time, George. Yeah, like at the trapeze with those chicks.
Yeah.
Because he saw the guy that was surrounded by chicks. Alan's
gotten laid by telling people that he's me. And I'm just really disappointed. People think I'm that too much of a...
I do that all the time.
Frog-faced looking
kind of
guy. I've
been Steve Kane before for years, too.
And that hasn't gotten you laid at all, though. That's just... that gets you a free meal, but it doesn't get you any free poon.
Can I just say, while I walked in and
can I stop you?
You can say Steve quickly and let Steve sit back down. Craig Worthing is one of the mans, the original man that gave me my start in radio.
Aww.
And I've been waiting to kill you for 40 years.
And the funny part is,
that mistake. You must have done.
Craig doesn't even recognize you. He has no idea who this guy is. That's the amazing part.
We'll share a little story. I was working at WOCN in Miami, and we bought an FM station called WINZ-FM, which became Zeta 4. In the meantime, WINZ had a talk show on you and Alfred. Remember Alfie?
No.
And I would come over. Al Anderson had me come over to learn the equipment and stuff. And I would be with you and Bert and Bernard
in
the studio every night. And Alfie, I would come to the... Remember you lived at the house at the transmitter, at the WINZ transmitter?
The station gave it to me, yeah.
I spent weeks and nights there. We taught a lot about radio at that transmitter site.
You must have been a kid.
I was 13.
Oh, my God.
Years later, I had the privilege of working with... So Craig Worthing, one of my godfathers in radio. Years later, I had the privilege of working with Steve Kane when his mind was still intact.
Oh, time ago I lost that.
Yeah, with Steve and Al at WNWS during its heyday when Jefferson Pilot bought WNWS. Oh. That's it, and now I'm hooked up with George. And look what we've built. Look what my career has led to. This beautiful room.
Where would be
better off without Alan?
Why, without Alan, this studio would be still here and sounding exactly the same.
Somebody hand me a pistol. It's time to go.
Time to go for a break because I got to go to the bathroom. I'm drinking a lot of water and coffee. 9 till 2 on all Alan Michaels radio, SoFloRadio.com.
SoFloRadio.com. Doing to terrestrial radio what they did to you. SoFloRadio.com.
I'm having a hell of a time finding Bill Shatner on there, man. He's trying to find a life.
I got it.
Okay.
You really want to hear this.
Yeah. Oh, sure, a little bit anyway. Come on.
All right, let's
be a sport now, Jay.
The way they've got these turntables fixed up in here, it's like you got to, like, do four things at once.
I know. It's a hell life, but we figure you can handle it. Oh, this
there
is good.
Is. Yeah, this is great. Now, who is this?
This is William Shatner.
Oh,
this
Mr. Tambourine
Captain
Man.
Captain Kirk. This is the definitive version of Mr. Tambourine Man.
On Zeta 4.
Yeah, but whatever you do, don't step on it. It's a long talk.
I don't think you can step on it.
No. You want to bet? I have that feeling now that any second...
Come on. Hey. Mr. Tambourine Man? Mr. Tambourine Man?
This fits in perfect. This could be Steely Dan.
This is the definitive version.
Yeah.
I'll be damned.
Little bubbles, I mean.
You know, I could
could have done my news story over the intro.
Put it on 45.
I think they did this album.
I'm
like,
not sleepy.
And there is no place I'm going to. They did this in one afternoon.
Yeah. Okay, that's, I think, enough of that for right now.
From the land of the free and the home of the talk, this is RadioAmerica.us.
He's back, and he's stalking a psycho who wants to make the Chicago Cubs pennant contenders. Clint Eastwood is Dirty Harry Carey.
Hello, everybody. This is Harry Carey with Steve Stone, and the f***ing Cubs are getting the beat out of them today.
Clint Eastwood gives a Hall of Fame performance as the legendary Cubs broadcaster. There's action.
The pitch. Strike at the d***. He threw that f***ing ball right past Clark.
Suspense.
It might be. It f***ing could be. It is a f***ing home run.
Romance.
Oh, look at the d*** on that broad, Steve. Holy cow, s***.
Clint Eastwood is Dirty Harry Carey. Coming to a theater near you.
Same old soup, try something new. New Surprise Me Soups from Campbell's. You'll love new chicken lice, bean with grease, French bunion, chunky dandruff, and hearty cheddar chim.
How's the soup, dear?
Great. Oh, look out the window, Marge, a UFO!
Where?
New Surprise Me Soups.
Soup is strange food.
Where the hell's the soup, asshole?
Oh! I want the soup right now, okay? I want it right away.
Oh, won't somebody try to get me some young guy
child, some young guy. I could just die for some young guy. And I want my soup right now, okay? I want it right away. Some young guy, the best soup you can buy. Somebody bring me mine. Some young guy. Some young guy feels so alive. And I want my soup right now, okay? I want it right away. I look around, there ain't no soup to be found. Don't you be a putz, just go see Mr. Yutz. I could just die for some young guy. I want my soup right now, okay, I want it right away. I want my soup right now, okay, I want my soup right now, okay. I want my soup right now, okay, I want my soup right now, okay.
We can talk over this one, right, Boca Brian? We were just talking about Joy Kaufman, and Steve was talking about what a whore she is, what a sellout whore she is.
Don't,
and I wanted to know, can you clarify, if does her vagina smell like a humpback whale, a rotting humpback whale carcass, or a beluga whale carcass? Because I've heard conflicting stories. Some people say beluga, other people say no, that's full-on humpback, rotting, beach humpback whale that you can smell from a mile away upwind. Which one is it? When the wind's right, I can smell it here when the wind's right.
That's awful. That's awful.
That's what I heard. I heard it was awful. Just, you know, I heard it was disgusting, yes.
She's
a bad person and a crazy kind of loony.
I didn't say any of those things.
No, Steve didn't. I said. That was me. I want to own all those.
What's the cause of your hostility?
Oh, I hate sellout whores. That's all. And, you know, and I hate her shoes. Those sensible, really round-toed dyke shoes that she wears.
I've never seen
that. I hate people for the wildest things.
Seen her
Joyce,
shoes?
Unfortunately, never gave me back something she borrowed from me 100 years ago.
Your virginity?
I wish I had them to bring here.
That's funny.
They were pictures of Neil. I wish I had to show.
That is funny.
I really.
She took your virginity. She took your dignity and never brought it back. Unbelievable.
But anyway, I want to thank you very much. This has been unusual.
Well,
and
that's how we do it. Yes. Thank you for noticing that.
That's different than that preamble to it, which was rather
the Joyce
disgusting.
Thing I've been wanting. That's a pressing
question.
Can we
get out the Joyce thing and talk about something else, for God's sake?
We can. The whole reason that we're doing this is that we've all worked with Neil. Neil touched our lives in one way or another. The people that you hear right now, for the people that are relatively new, you know, Craig, Steve, and myself are people with a years-long history with Neil.
The real Neil,
sideways.
I must just say, because you knew him at a later time, but the real Neil was a shy, humble guy.
He was very shy. I don't know.
You were ever with Neil socially, which I spent a lot of time with Neil.
Neil was much more humble than he could have
been.
He didn't like to be recognized. Right. He didn't want to be the center of attention off the air, at least when I knew him.
He was very, very shy. In reality.
And Neil, for a long while, was an unhappy guy. I'm glad he ended up with some happiness.
But I can tell you this, as we are about to leave, and thank you for the gracious invitation.
Oh, pleasure is mine. I'm honored.
Here. Just a final note on Joyce Kaufman. We have done this... We have done this retrospective, those of us who worked with Neil and those of us...
You brought her on the radio.
I have to own that. I am responsible for Joyce being on the air, for better or for worse.
It's your fault.
Yes, I hired her.
She still is.
The point I wanted to make, all of us who were professional colleagues of Neil's and friends of those who were friends of Neil, you will all be in for a huge shock at his funeral, because what's going to happen is the chief speaker is going to be Joyce Kaufman, who is going to tell you that she's been Neil's best friend his whole life, and that they were so close, and all the wonderful things they shared together, because Joyce speaks at every funeral and says that, with the possible exception of mine, I doubt that she'll do that.
I don't go to funerals, so...
Don't you?
You have to tell me.
Yeah, are you going to go to yours? Because I'm going to.
No, I'm not having a funeral. I'm not having a funeral.
No funeral? How can you do that?
Instant cremation. Spread them
Why are you
place.
Doing that? Why are you doing that? You're depriving your friends and
no, we're gonna
the last
party.
Chance
they'll
to
have a
agree.
Party. Parties I'm for.
Okay. Okay. She'll be there, right?
We'll do it Irish style. We'll have Irish a nice wake. We'll wake. Drink.
Yeah. Sounds good.
Absolutely. Steve, thank you very much.
Nice to you.
Craig Worthy, we're going to change the guard. We will do this again. It's going to take... Craig, a half hour to make it down those stairs. He's not making it up with his
time. I want to be out the door when he tries.
Don't be down.
Or
don't,
behind
don't be downhill from him when he does this. Gentlemen, thank you very much.
You leave first, Craig.
Joe Castello, we're gonna switch this out like hockey, man. Without taking a break and without stopping the play, we're gonna just roll everything around.
Craig, Steve, thank you very much for joining us.
Take care.
Did you hear that,
hey,
Steve?
Nice to
Craig, Boca Bryan says thank you. Steve.
Boca Bryan, nice hearing from you again, all right? Nice reminiscing about the old days.
It was great hearing from you, too.
All right, and Boca Bryan, your mic is just a little bit hot. I know that while you were running around trying to get things figured out, you probably turned your mic up a little bit. Steve, thank you. We'll be in touch. We're going to have a religious debate. Yeah, it's all right. I'll wear a sign. Something a little bit more obvious.
So I got to follow that.
That, yeah.
Impossible.
I know.
Impossible.
It was a very momentous thing. I don't think, I don't know if Steve and Craig have been on the air lately or how long it's been since they have been on the air, but certainly, not here together with me with all the, our open format. They were
speak,
saying
Joe,
Judy
speak.
And Kaka. And Ellen, and I think
should we wait for the thump at the end of the stuff?
I think that's what we're doing right now. Boca
is there
Bryan
a headset
and,
so I can hear
audience.
Boca Bryan? I can't hear.
Right there, man. We have the guest headset. This is a new piece of equipment since you've been here.
I love. There's
the
a whole bunch of new equipment
shiny,
since I've been here. I'm
first of all, finally joined the modern age. I got an extra mic boom to go with.
The mic booms are incredible, and I am currently in the middle of a debate about our studio.
Oh yeah.
Whether or not to continue with headset mics, which is what we have.
I debate this as well. People.
Because a lot of people don't have good mic technique, and the headset mic forces it.
Indeed it does. And they can hear, but the headsets are expensive compared to mic booms.
And heavy.
And free microphones. I also like that it looks like a radio studio. It makes me kind of, I walk in, it looks like a radio studio, and I feel good.
I think that's pretty important.
And other people walk in, and they this is a radio studio, totally. Never mind the crack pipe on the table, and the naked chick in the corner, a sleeping one off. It's still, because that's actually radio studio decor anyway.
I agree with
a real radio station.
Everything you're saying right now.
And when you have the overhead kind of thing, you don't need the headphones. Some of us obviously like
that. I hope no one's masturbating in the sink.
You just, it's not just for men. You can sit in the sink and masturbate.
What was that, the 70s or the 80s that happened?
I'm not sure. We went over a lot of
early
80s.
It's a crime you can't masturbate in the sink anymore. At these radio stations, corporate America has destroyed.
I think.
It wasn't immediate firing. He was reasonable. Can you go into the bathroom? That's what I took at.
People remember at QAM, because I was just saying before you showed up, at QAM, remember, because we had our own little studios over there, people used my particular studio as a masturbation station.
You have no idea what happened in that studio.
See, I have an idea. An idea. And that's enough.
You have no idea.
That's why I wiped it down every day.
Well, it wasn't so much dirty sexual grossness. It was more... questionable.
Were they doing rails on the counter? Because then I shouldn't have wiped it up. I should have licked it.
I don't think I'm prepared. I'm not ready to tell those stories yet, George.
There's a new version of Let's Make a Deal. Someone comes into a studio and you point to a counter and it said, one of three things has happened on this counter. Someone had sex on the counter, someone ejaculated on the counter and then cleaned it up, or people were doing rails and then just wiped it real quick with their hand and then left. So you can either lick it or clean it.
I'm not saying anything at this moment.
A pretty girl sat on it. People were doing rails on it, or somebody cranked out a batch on it. Which one?
It was neither of the biological fluids.
Well, I know from experience the kind of things that happen at radio stations overnight, whether you tell me or whether you don't. Especially
just lick 'em.
In a studio that has a lock on the door.
Oh, absolutely.
Cable TV and a lock on the door.
You give a bunch of guys the keys to a radio station between 2 and 6, and you just say, run around, and there's strippers there.
Right.
Occasionally,
right.
There will be a lack of judgment for a moment or two.
I don't call it that.
So, bottom line, though, that was great stuff. I was listening around. I was jamming out on my HTC Evo.
Yes.
And hearing these guys, it makes me sad. I know I feel great. It was great programming, great broadcasting, and
right.
I have no idea what the numbers are. But it makes me sad that era is over. Is that the reason I'm sad? That era is over?
We're trying to keep it alive.
On the radio, see, it's radio that is over. Radio is over. It's Pandora, Last FM, MySpace Music.
Wi-Fi is the new FM.
Right, Wi-Fi is the new FM.
L'chaim.
You're aware now that I'm loading all the dads from WIOD, from the DCS, and you know the ones you two guys did.
Mm.
And the last dat I got to, remember where those dats were sitting? There is an entire dolphin game. They erased the whole dat.
They took the dats out of my studio that I would use as my storage dats, the backup dats, the library, and they used it to record a dolphin game. That's what Boca Bryan. That's the point that he's saying, right? So that's Gazan.
See, what it is, in my opinion, is disrespect for their own product.
They have no idea.
Disrespect for the own product.
Those
like we just had,
heads.
You know,
yeah.
Craig and Steve were in here, and I don't know. I had heard those guys referenced by Neil. Was pretty much the extent of my knowledge. To hear them both on the air, you can tell.
And Craig is funny, by the way.
They were both around.
Craig has a sense of humor. He's obviously a radio guy. He's not somebody that didn't belong on the radio. I heard, Steve said it, Neil said it too. He was very nice, maybe too nice for his own good on the air. But Craig is a funny guy.
Always enjoyed hearing Craig.
He's got good radio. I don't know how else to say that.
Talk radio is a great format. And people, they just disrespected it. Disrespected it.
It's the camp, these people, the right-wing politics and the sports talk and networking stuff. Management isn't going to fire themselves. They're going to fire the talent and then open up a pot and bring in some network stuff. But the talent isn't going to just go away somewhere. We all went over here. This is where we're at now. And
things are going good, by the way. I've been looking at the response has been great.
Mm-hmm.
I just wish that the word was getting out even more. I wish that the people out there that were listening to your program were taking a little self-initiative.
Come on, spam that out.
Exactly. And understand that, look, that this is not, don't be selfish. This is something, every time I come on your show, I turn into a shill
for
the program. Because you're not going to do it. Georgie's not going to do it. Monica's not going to do it. So I come on here, and I've got to tell the audience that you guys are failing. Because nobody knows that this is going on. You need to signal your friends.
They're very complacent. They're very laid back. It's a southern kind of mentality. Did you hear Phil on with us?
No. I still have to.
Last half hour of Monday. It was great.
Fortunately, I can go into the archive and listen.
Yes. There's no such thing as missing a show
anymore. How is Phil Hendry?
Phil is vibrant.
Is he still right wing or
delectable?
What's his story?
We never even got there. We were talking about old times. We were talking about funny things that we did. The burning dog and I used my bag of chips. We found talking about the Castro message and things that we used to do. And by the way, Boca Bryan, do you have that? It's a 10-minute segment.
Phil does George. Put the stick.
I don't have that. I found a lot of new Phil, but not that one.
You put the stick in turn.
I have
you
that.
You twist.
I think I have Phil does George.
Edelman.
Hendry. I got a lot of Phil Hendry. I think it's just under Phil does George.
D is in lunch truck. X.
I got it. I got Phil does George. It's 10 minutes and 25 seconds. Do we want to play that today?
No.
No. Okay.
No. No, because, I've got a lot of Phil segments. It'll take forever.
Good. Yeah, no, I want to do that.
So did you go see Neil?
Yes, I did.
And?
I saw Neil last week, and it was a very sad thing.
Huh.
He's, we got him to get a little bit conscious and interact a little bit. I got a word out of him. I said, hey, Neil, we got to go cut a spot. Can you cut a spot? And he holds up a finger and says, okay. And, he was making eye contact and following me around, but he's not doing well. And he is not going to be doing more well. He's going to be doing less well. And, want me to be candid?
Yes.
It was really, really difficult to see him that way. I felt very powerless because for a lot of time it was my job to deal with his issues. so that he would do the show. And it's my job, producer. You know, it's like, what? You just got to operate around him, get, you know, if he needs a toothpick or gum, it's like, it's my job to get Neil into a position where he can do a show. If
producer job.
Picking
personal
him up
assistant.
Walking him
number
from
one
his car.
Rule.
Carrying him in, like, piggyback fashion from the car and sitting him down to do a show, but there's absolutely nothing I could have done for him there. And I squirted some on the way home.
I'm sure you did.
And
how could you not? 20 years with a person, and there is a very strong... You remember we had a great conversation mm-hmm. over at my studio about that, and I just... Mm-hmm. The relationship between you guys, I was there for a speck of time, and mm-hmm. I can't imagine what it must feel like.
It's rough, because he's my professional father figure. This, what I'm doing right now, and everything I learned about talk radio, and even the notion that talk radio could be entertaining from an audience member's perspective and fun from a this-is-my-job perspective, all of those things, if not for Neil, I would not have believed either of those things. I wouldn't have believed that talk radio could be entertaining or fun, if not for Neil. And then, obviously, years and years of working with him. I told Dave, Neil's friend, And I told Jicka, because when I was talking to Jicka last, like 2 weeks ago or something, when this was all happening, a lot of people, whatever you can say about your job, I never had a pit in my stomach driving into work. You know, I didn't wake up in the morning on a work day and go, oh, God. You know, maybe the drive, I wasn't looking forward to the drive, but I knew that as soon as 10 o'clock hit, I was going to be having fun and it was going to fly.
I used to love when you went on vacation.
Yeah,
because
it was you.
Because then it was me, and at first... I would, you warned me pretty well that Neil was not a bad guy and was going to, if something went wrong, he was going to rage against management and not against me. And so I went into it feeling pretty confident that I could get through.
Right.
And not only did I get through, but I had great times and great interaction and I learned a lot. And it was fun. It was so much fun. The clips that you're playing, that Boca, I guess, is playing, of Neil doing Craig. Earlier, I was listening to that on the way in, and it was great. It was great. We miss Tom Jicka, speaking of which. You know, Tom catches a lot of hell for all his American Idol stuff and basically going with the flow of the masses, which is something that, you know, we're generally against. But he's probably right, and we're probably wrong. We're swimming upstream, and he's doing well. But Tom has done a good job. Without Tom Jicka, who would know?
Right.
Who would be writing these stories without Tom Jicka? If there was no Tom Jicka, and I hate to give Tom Jicka so much credit, but who would write these stories about Neil? Who would be keeping us updated?
Well, Ellie Brecker. I mean, when this hit, there were a lot of people.
Where's she
writing? Herald, the Miami Herald. She contacted me. I don't know. I guess you don't read the Herald. I think she wrote something. I don't know. Because I don't read the Herald either.
Tom Jicka goes out of his way to email and stuff.
Right.
And
right, it's posted on the blog. Hey, what have you done, Ellie? She might be waiting.
Yeah,
no, we talked.
Oh yeah, let's wait till the guy kicks to celebrate his life. Oh yeah, he's gone.
Well, we're not, obviously. We're not. That's why this is a vigil. It's a vigil / tribute, and then
Boca,
it's going to be a eulogy.
Something.
Sorry, Boca.
See if this rings a bell. No. Phil's theme.
That's Phil's theme?
That's what they opened his show with.
I called Phil once.
That
My only call.
Familiar with me at all. That's weird.
No, I remember it. I remember.
Sounds very generic. I got no recollection of that whatsoever.
Well, we don't have Fadick around to talk over it, but that's the bed.
Hey, baby, you melt my jockey shorts.
We should get Fadick on the show.
Shenanigans, baby back ribs. Okay. I'll write it down on the list of people to invite.
You've been doing well with this.
There's been some hit or misses, and I got waiting for responses from people. And today, like, the Skype has never failed us. You know what? By the way, Broker Brown, I figured it out. It's that update. It's working on the computer.
That son of a bitch update. You know what that put me through this morning? Jesus Christ.
On your machine and my machine, where we both did the update, the Skype isn't working. On the machine where I didn't do the update, Skype working just fine. How do you like that? So there.
Forced me to do it.
Oh, after all this time. And I can't find, like, the old version of the software. I was going to go uninstall, reinstall, do the old version of the software. Can't do it. Can't find it. Am I still going to go up and visit you today, Boca Brian?
Yeah, we still
have
that.
All right, I'm going to leave here at 4 at the very latest. Alan's
across the street from this office we're going to is a Sonic.
Oh, excellent. Good. We can
And I noticed that the Sonic
They have roller skating attendance.
Sonic in South Florida? That's great. Where is that, folks?
It's in Lake Northless.
Jeez.
All right. So if anything, if this goes bottom up, then you got a job there. You could just...
I could be... They need skaters. What do you call it? There's a name for it, the roller skating.
Homosexual male. on wheels. Yeah, I will not allow you to be a roller skating waitress, George. No matter what happens.
What if I got a nice push-up bra?
Lend me one, Boca. Nice
push-up bra, a little bit. I'll have to shave my chest for the first time.
I have things.
I heard.
It was guys skating when I drove by that
really?
Place.
Really? No. Were they wearing little shorts?
No, it was just some dude.
Something hop. Kids. Isn't it a something hop?
Car hop.
There it is.
Car
hop.
Yeah.
Like an American graffiti.
Yeah.
Like a sip and sup. You know, like car hops. Old school. That's what it was all about when we were burning.
Why eat at a table when you can eat in your car?
Exactly. And with a cute waitress. Well, all right.
And they were cute. I never understood that. It's like I actually drove to a restaurant, but I got to stay in my car.
Well, you don't have to stay in the car. You park your car, and then you get out, and you talk with other people in their cars, and everybody's got a cool car because you're at a car hop.
Oh.
Remember, this is a different era when all the cars were cool.
Yeah.
And you'd get out, and you'd talk, and you'd meet girls, and they'd come around, and they'd hop in your car, and you'd go for a cruise, and you'd come back to the car hop, and you'd have something else, and it was a way to get laid.
See,
George, now I've got you hooked. Way to get laid, George.
Well, listen, if it's good for the girls, it's good for the guys, too.
I mean, what's cooler than cool cars? So you're talking to a car person here, me and Boca.
Money.
What, money?
Of course. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah,
well,
see, that's a very modern, Monica, very modern. Well, how do you get the cool car? You obviously have to have money. You know, maybe you should cut out the middleman. We'll just have money bars where people go out there and you just kind of fan out your hundreds and you put them over your crotch and the women come around. How about that?
Maybe there's a
pile of money and we all just all roll around in it.
That's all in the DNA,
can't take any
Monica.
With you. That's why you got to walk into the money room naked because they don't want you. Like when you're processing cocaine, you know how they make you do that naked? In case you steal some so that you don't have any place to put it. Although, I know people that would find a place to put it.
Really?
If they were naked.
A balloon?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Some sort of...
the processing.
On that note...
I'm going to run that Craig Worthing for Joe.
Do that. 220. SoFloRadio.com.
Excellent.
Neil Young.
Greg?
Yeah.
Greg who?
You know Greg who...
Oh, Greg. I thought you meant Craig.
Greg. Said something about 2A.
Oh, I thought you meant Craig Worthing.
We don't like to knock on this show. We don't want to talk about 2A or any other place. If we got something positive to say, go ahead. And we can talk about the Red Sox. They won 11 games in a row. The Red Sox are going to do it this year. They're going to be in this series, friends. And I'm going to go to Fenway and stand outside the ballpark because I haven't got enough money to buy a ticket. You don't know what it's like, friends, to drive around McDonald's and not be able to buy a Big Mac.
Oh, that Craig, I'm telling you. It's 9:13 on Zeta 4. It's been a wild 12 years in this market, boy. It's been really something. But, of course, all good things must come to an end.
Longer, firmer, and fully packed. With flavor. SoFloRadio.com.
SoFloridaDiscounts.com. SoFloridaDiscounts.com. This website is crazy. SoFloridaDiscounts.com. Electronics, dining out, real estate, automobiles, boats, yachts, golf clubs. Crazy discounts, jewelry, and more. SoFloridaDiscounts.com. SoFloridaDiscounts.com.
After rocking South Florida for over 30 years, she's back. And she's South Florida's classic rock again. She's only rockandroll.com.
She's gonna rock.
SoFloRadio.com. Give us a call at 954-990-0036. Skype name SoFloRadio. Mobile users call 954-990-0036.
Tell that Rick Sanchez to squat on this. Oh!
You can take the station.
Run it in the ground.
Drink a quart of vodka and take the next bus out of town. The PD man can.
The PD man can.
The PD man can.
The PD man can.
The PD man can. Cause he thinks he's freaking God and screws the station up good.
Screws the station up good.
Ah, the PD man could take talent you would hate.
gives the job to his sister, talking about raising blisters. I want to wish this crap on Hitler. Who can take Neil Rogers? That then moved to Buffalo. The PD man can.
The PD man can.
The PD man can.
The PD man can.
The PD man can. Cause he thinks he's freaking God and screws the station up good.
Screws the station up good.
Yeah, the PD man can. Cause he thinks he's freaking God and screws the station up good.
Screws the station up good.
Yeah, the PD man can. Cause he thinks he's freaking God and screws the station up good.
Screws the station up good.
Oh, my good friend Neil Rogers.
Cause he thinks he's freaking God.
Scotty Chapin, Mike Glor, Scott Schwartz, Herman and McBean, Gail Bright, Coleman Chandler, Sandy Deal, April Wortham, Glenn Wild, Steve Stansel, don't forget Bill Wise, Sharon Mahoney, Johnny Dolan, Aileen Epstein, Amos Goble, Ann Hummel, Stan Major, Dorothy McIntyre, the prize, Jerry, Larry, Pottle, Connie Foote, Sharon Francis, Joan Hayes, Sisters Weasel, and the Farrah Parr. We can't forget the people, though we try to hide them and forget. Even though there's times they made us lose our minds. Henry Barrow, Rick, Alfred, Jim, Dean, Gary, Bruce, Jeff Clark, Johnny Dark, and Joe Zagacki. Hank Goldberg, Meg Green, Marvin, Roman, Laura Reed, Stephanie Lewis, Gwen Edwards, don't forget McQueen. These aren't all the people who are still here working, and Neil's still burping. We are all the people who are out there giving just to make a living.
I would like to exterminate rabbits.
What's up, Doc?
And we're out there giving just to make a living. We are all the people.
225, SoFloRadio.com, George Rodriguez, Boca Brian, Monica, Joe Castello, and, yeah, Alan Michaels sipping on some coffee over here, too. I'm trying an experiment, a spearmint here, Boca Brian, uninstalling Skype and installing a older version of it and then not updating it.
Why are you putting an older version? Go ahead, Boca.
Because that the older version is the one that worked.
Yeah, but won't they make you update that, too?
Remember, they asked you, hey, new version of Skype out, don't you want to update it? And I'm like,
oh, yeah, sure.
Well, I do if I force anyway.
Though they asked you if you wanted to. You can always say no. You can always run an older version of any software. Nobody's going to make you. I mean, I don't know how it works in the Apple world.
Can I make fun of Alan Michaels for a minute?
Well, good to take an hour.
Sure.
Step on up.
So I came by because...
Whatever you want to say.
This is my Santa day because Friday is Christmas Eve. I don't even know if you're going to be on. And so
we're running, like, highlights and things.
Exactly. So I like to come by and do my Santa stuff. And so I come in and do some Santa stuff, and George had some Santa stuff for me. It's great. Yeah. And we decided to break the Santa stuff open, and we're drinking, and Alan Michaels is
drinking
like,
some
yeah, pour me something. And
these are our fake names, by the way. It's Woody Doer and Willie Doer, the Doer brothers.
I like it.
Anyway,
and I can tell you that not a drop of his...
That's the second one. He swiped that.
No way.
No, I didn't.
Yeah,
it's the same.
No, grab the microphone,
really,
Alan.
It's just really don't drink.
It's the second
I just
one.
Do drugs.
He swiped that.
It's an accessory. You're just carrying it around. It's not right.
No, I carry it just like women. I can be with them, but they don't touch me.
What's this trapeze business that you guys are talking about?
Ooh. We went. We judged a Halloween contest there.
We were judges.
You weren't there.
And what we're trying to nurture, nurture a relationship.
Stand by. You were there, Monica?
She was there.
Yes, I was.
Oh. We have pictures. You know,
she has a story.
We posted.
Yes, I did.
We posted pictures. Yeah, she has a story about Alan humping her leg.
Did you have coitus?
I did not. The only bone I got was the rib. Thank you very much.
Boo.
That's funny.
And Alan, true.
We got lots of stories. Like, do you know Johnny Dolan? Have you ever
heard? Oh, no. Oh, no. Here we go again.
What? This is part of the story.
Doesn't it work at the Sterling
Alan Michael Sterling.
Alan, and by the way, I got, because here's the thing.
No, the answer is no. I don't know. Shotgun Johnny
Let
Dolan.
Let me go through the story. I'm going to try to prattle this off really quickly. Get an email from one of my wife's friends, one of my wife's good friends. She only has two. Inga, I call her. And she says, are you spitting something? Oh, very good. Just bring the bottle. Inga sends me an email saying that, hey, the Trapeze is having a Halloween costume contest on Friday, and they're looking for celebrity judges. And I thought that it would be a nice promotional thing. And remember, we know the people have a good relationship with Alan, and now there's another Alan at Trapeze. And so I forwarded along to my pimp and agent, Alan. Michaels, now we're talking about three Alans.
Finally, I get a title, pimp and agent. Yes.
Pimp
I love that.
And agent, I like it.
Hey, Alan, because he claimed that he knew the guy at Trapeze, and I said, why don't you get us in there for the costume contest? And he does that. He manipulates, but also he worms his own way in. He gets to be one of the judges also, Alan Michaels. So
good move.
I'm thinking,
they thought I was Neil.
You know how this is done. For the audience,
Neil,
Joe Castello, back when we had the hookup, Joe Castello, his crew, Jorge Rodriguez and his crew, we would go to the clubs and we would always bring more women than dudes.
Right.
Because that's the only way that we can look like respectable, pimpy, heterosexual men. Joe and I both with extra chicks. Pimpy as all hell. Yo, yo. Alan is inviting dudes to go with him.
What is the meaning of this?
I'll tell you. Because they were short judges. They said, do you know any other radio people you can bring as a judge? And my friend Johnny Dolan, he likes to show himself. There's the famous Neil story, how he walked into the bathroom at IOD.
They urinated together.
Right.
Side by side.
So I said, hey, Johnny Dolan's perfect for this. Can I bring my friend Johnny Dolan? He's been on like all the stations in town. They said, bring him. He was a judge. So it turned out he wasn't a judge, but he came, and George thought he was more like I was bringing him with me like you would normally bring a chick.
That's a different night, Alan.
But anyway, so we were all judges. George and Monica left early. Johnny Dolan kept me there. He was in the back room all night.
Towled
long.
Up, huh? Did the
oh
towel on the first
God.
Night? Towled up?
I didn't hear this story.
He's skipping over. We don't care about Johnny Dolan in the back room. We care that, first of all, he shows up in a trench coat, and I'm like,
right. But I didn't.
I know what this, and he's got his pants legs. Taped. He's just got pant bottom below the knee,
yeah.
Taped to his leg.
He hangs out with Footy too much.
I'm telling you. And he walks in, and he's got, at least, he's flashing people, but he had some black underwear. And I was thankful for that, but not long enough, because he goes into the bathroom, he takes off the underwear, so now he's flashing everything. He flashed Monica. Another guy flashed Monica, humps her thigh with his naked package. She got teabagged while we were there. Thank God for the ribs, or she would have smacked me, because that's how good the ribs were. The ribs were so good.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievably good. The guy's going to come up and teabag Monica's ear, and she wouldn't have even noticed it.
It's a very unique crowd over there.
But it was a fun night.
I had a great time.
And the wife's friend had a good time. She said, I got rave reviews.
So wait a second. You went back to one of these places and once again left early with nothing happening.
Ooh. He did. He was so proper.
Me,
all these stories
yes.
you hear about
right
George
back
on
to
the
1998.
Air, he was the most
right. Once again, right
guy.
Back. Well, I was there with my wife's best friend, and I wasn't going to hit on her.
No,
because she
of
would totally,
no.
totally tell my wife. I got a good report. She said George, he danced whenever anybody wanted to dance. If me or Monica, anybody wanted to dance, even if George had just
That's
danced
great.
Two songs, George was there to
You'd
dance.
Be perfect at a wedding.
And then on the way back. Right, like I turned left, like I pulled out of the parking lot, turned left, there was the checkpoint, the DUI checkpoint,
oh, yeah.
right
yeah.
there. I Jedi mind tricked my way through the checkpoint.
These are not the droids you're looking for.
I said, this is not the DUI, this is not the drug driver you're looking for. And I'm dressed like Mike Hawk with a superhero and a utility belt. My utility belt's in the back room, license and registration, please. And I'm like, they're my utility belt, mind if I go get it? Because the utility belt looks very militaristic.
What was the crowd like? How's
nice.
The crowd
We went
here.
On Friday. Normally,
sure.
we would go on Saturdays.
Oh, yeah, because Friday is...
Yeah, the singles.
Gangbang night.
Yeah.
And so we went on Friday, but you know what? There were a lot of chicks there. I thought it was going to be all dudes and, like, one slut. No, it was very mixed. I didn't see actually more men than women, except, of course, for Alan and his crew of sausage that he brought in with him. He was the only one. But Johnny was getting my wife's friend Inga to touch him by pretending that he needed something written on his chest. And he's all sweaty and hairy, and he's got this El Marco marker.
Oh, my God, there's a fly on me. Can you swat it off?
Shh. That's landlord. Let's be quiet.
Oh, another talk show host outside?
Linda. I'm not going to
He's not upset that my
Joyce
car is
Kaufman.
Parked there,
She's
right?
banging at the door.
You really destroyed Joyce Kaufman. I thought it was great.
Oh, that was
fucking
great.
Yeah, that was great. If ballots won't work, bullets will.
Mouth drop open. That was amazing.
Yeah, it was great. That was a good moment. I think that's promo, Boca.
So I just froze all my shit up here.
She got a little national publicity a couple of weeks back.
She sure
did.
Yeah, how'd that pay off?
I'm going to be the chief of staff for Alan West.
Still nobody loses.
And then that crazy bitch.
Except she's on every day, man. She's doing well. See, you've got to be a right-wing Nazi to be on the air.
I will not be a sellout.
You're not going to be on the air.
My vagina does not smell like rotting whale carcass.
Brokered makes no difference anymore, Boca. I used to feel like brokered was a bad thing, too. Like, oh, my God, you can't get somebody to pay you to be on. You must suck. Yeah, nobody gets paid to do anything anymore unless you're talking something mainstream.
But still, for a professional broadcaster to broker their own time, it's a downer. It's something you don't want to do.
You got to do what you got to do nowadays, though.
Oh, it's survive for the fish.
And she's
now
on
the
every day. She's on with her propaganda. These people are evil. And
she's on a local AM. This is a worldwide project we have going on.
Well, we're
here.
Not comparing the two. I'm just saying that she's evil.
She is.
She is evil.
Evil, disgusting.
I still asked her on a date, though.
Really?
I did.
I better watch out.
And
she said
I'm not
no.
surprised.
Ew.
She said no.
What's creepier, having sex with Alan or having sex with Joyce?
You should ask her to go to the survey.
You should ask her to go to the gun range first. She would have said yes.
Oh, maybe. See, that's how you do it, Alan. Yeah, I would teach you something, but I don't want to give anybody any advantage. I want to help guys get laid.
Yeah.
That's a dog-eat-dog world there.
That's terrible, George. It's the numbers. It's a numbers game. There's so many women out there.
But
you should
miss her on the telethon. She used to be on the telethon. Was it the Jerry Lewis telethon?
I have no idea.
Shut before he died.
I know nothing of the woman other than her work on 850.
Yeah. All right, experiment failure.
Why are you doing tech stuff during the show, man?
Uninstalled Skype, and it didn't make a difference, Boker, Brian. It's Skype.
I don't think people like all the tech stuff that goes on the show.
Neil used to bring everybody in.
Yeah,
inside.
But there's so much more of it now.
Yeah, George is good at that. He can do a talk show and work on a computer at the same time.
Not like Nicole Sandler. You got to watch her work.
How's that?
She needs extra arms. She can actually talk.
She's the hottest working woman in the radio business.
She can talk, and she's running three computers at the same time. She's tweeting, chatting, blogging, posting things on Facebook, all while she's doing the show, all while she's calling
and hosting Randy this week.
She's hosting Randy this week. Thank you for reminding me, because we didn't mention it on Monday. Nicole Sandler in for Randy Rhodes all this week. Randy's supposedly in town, and I've been emailing her back and forth, hopefully, like I was hoping to get her on today, but she didn't get back to me.
Broward.
So I might have to stalk her
up. She's clearly our best show next to yours.
Oh, thank you. You know, it used to be Joe, but then, you know.
Yeah.
I know.
What do you mean?
I'm still home.
WFTL Radio, 9 o'clock.
Things on the
Yankee roll call, 11 a.m. Saturday.
Huge things on the horizon. New people are going to be taking control. And
I want to. It's about survival, guys. You got to understand. I need to put money, otherwise I lose everything.
I defend Joe all the time when people say that's fucking Joe Castello. What an asshole.
He bailed on that
show to do that racing show. Who the fuck is talking about racing?
Exactly. Well, there's a lot of people that do, and they have money, and they want to buy sponsorships, and that will sustain my life and allow me to pay for my mortgage and then get back to enacting change in the world. And showing
Joe, your political views, your political talk show that you did on SoFloRadio Radio
was
fabulous.
It was
nice balance.
You need to contribute to the world in that way.
I agree with you, Alan, but... You know, there's only so many hours in the day, and I was spread too thin.
Money's the bottom line.
Listen, a wise man, George, once told me that nothing is permanent.
Right.
And that it was the advice of the Buddha.
That is Buddha.
Nothing is permanent. And so this is just a short phase in time.
No doubt.
And as soon as I stabilize my life with a little financial stability, maybe something else, I can go right back to doing what I was doing. And people, you enjoyed it. George enjoyed it. I know we had a really good audience. Still second best on the station to this day. Mm-hmm. And so I was proud of that work, and people can go back into the SoFlo archive and listen to the greatness if they want.
Right.
Oh, yeah, the momentum.
But right now it's all about cash, man. It's all about survival. I'm thinking of taking like a job.
No, I know.
A job.
I'm doing an experiment over here. The lines just came back up.
Oh, really?
Skype up experiment.
One of the people I've been trying to get on the phone for a long time, and I just got a Facebook message from her, so I'm trying to get her on.
Yeah. Happy Hanukkah.
I'm
going
to be surprised. I'm not even going to tell you who it is until I get
drink up, Georgie.
It.
Come on. You're not rosy yet. And Alan, that thing is...
Sandy Payton.
After the show, man, this is going to be fun. I should eat some more soup.
Yes.
Answer the phone, lady.
Your call has been forwarded to an automatic voice
message. Yeah, well, I'm not going to let anybody know who the hell I was trying to talk to there. We'll wait till we get her on the air. Blast from the past. Trying to get a hold of all the people. You know, there's a whole history of Neil. Of 30, was it 36 years, Brian? Was that Neil that was on the air in this town?
Yeah.
Okay, because I only got the last 19.5 covered. So there's all these people before me. That's what Craig was doing here and people like that. But as far as, like, the IOD people... I'm in touch with a lot of those people that we worked with and Neil used to talk about and were part of that show. And a lot of the audience, they started with Neil at WIOD in those days. Like they, because, you know, there's this FM people and the AM people. And a lot of the AM people, they don't listen to the FM. So a lot of people, you know, first discovered Neil when he went over to QAM. I'm sorry, IOD. Mm. That was their first sampling of Neil, me, and a lot of other people. And, of course, Neil, of course, he brings everybody in from the staff. Everybody understands that. So I got contact with these people. I want them to call up and share. And if
what would you say? What would you say? Give me a, and Boca, I want your opinion on this as well. What would you say was the golden age of year, of Neil? Beginning what year and ending what year? Golden age. The prime, the peak, the pinnacle.
92, 2002.
George, okay, do you agree with that?
I do agree with that, and especially I'm biased because I was with him in those years. Neil enjoyed doing the show most during Zeta, and he said that a lot. Mm-hmm. That's when he had the most fun doing a show with all these people. Captain Dave, I got to get him on.
Morning radio.
Yeah. Morning Zoo Show.
Now,
he hated mornings.
In the morning.
He hated the mornings, but he really enjoyed what was going on at Zeta with all those people there at the time.
That was 88 now. So we should throw down.
Joe, you're a sports guy. You know, when Neil was on KAT, there was a young kid that was like an intern that worked at the station that Neil actually introduced into radio. And he's now one of the biggest sports broadcasters in the world. He's on Fox. His name is Chris Myers.
Chris Myers? Yeah, I know Chris Myers. Chris Myers does NASCAR on Fox.
Yeah.
Chris Myers knows Neil?
On the World Series, I see him in the locker room.
Chris Myers has got a great voice. He does a talk show. I don't know if he's still there on Fox Sports Radio. But, yeah, Chris Myers is a great talent.
Neil Rogers.
One of those God-given talents.
Introduced Chris to radio.
The Great Pipes.
He also, I think before he left town, he worked on Channel 10 locally and did sports, Chris Myers.
And I was listening to you the other day, you played the Larry King call.
Yeah.
And talked about how Larry called Neil from the airplane. Larry King with his big, I know a lot of people rip the crap out of Larry King. My view is that anybody that can just survive in this business for that long with success and continue to get paid, they did pretty well.
Oh, yeah.
That's all.
Good. On that note, it's 2:40 on all Larry King Radio, SoFloRadio.com.
Oi.
I'm Casey Kasem back here at Bayfront Park. Hi. And I've got Marguerite here. How you doing, Marguerite?
Fine, thank you.
What do you think about Phil Hendry on WIOD?
It's a beautiful,
thank you, sir. You're about three quarters done with that beer anyway, aren't you? No, I'm kidding. All right, let's get to a call. Quit bothering me. Don't touch me. I'm Casey Kasem. Nobody's allowed to touch me.
SoFloRadio.com. We rub you the right way.
If your party snacks taste like hell, this year at Christmas, serve Cheeses of Nazareth. Your guests will say, holy cow, when they bite into these sinfully rich treats. And Cheeses of Nazareth come in a variety of flavors, from jalapeno to hallelujah. Get the snack he would have liked, and the taste worth praying for. Cheeses of Nazareth. It's your salvation this Christmas. There's a Cheeses of Nazareth shop on Business Loop 80, right next to Chrysler Almighty Motors.
SoFloRadio.com.
Radio's Dirty Little Secret.
When you're ready to actually lose weight safely and steadily while being monitored by a physician, the Weight Loss Clinic of Dr. Kim Jacobson is there for you. The family medicine practice was established by her father in 1956 and continues as a medical practice that now specializes in weight reduction. Dr. Kim Jacobson joined the practice 20 years ago as both a family medicine practitioner and weight loss specialist. The Weight Loss Clinic utilizes a combination of appetite suppression medication and vitamins to produce great results, usually 3 to 4 pounds per week for most patients. Now you can change your lifestyle while still still enjoying your own food, just less of it. They offer a choice of 2, 3, or 4 week plans. So whether you just need to lose a few pounds or a lot, the Weight Loss Clinic of Dr. Kim Jacobson can help you. They're located at 5454 Northeast 4th Avenue in Miami, just two blocks west of 54th Street and Biscayne Boulevard. Call them at 305-751-0091. They'll be happy to answer any and all of your questions. That's 305-751-0091. Get started on a beautiful new body today with Dr. Kim Jacobson and the Weight Loss Clinic.
SoFloRadio.com. Give us a call at 954-990-0036. Skype name SoFloRadio. Mobile users call 954-990-0036.
Through air and sexual, 'cause she'll hang up the phone. If you're too risky, so tiptoe through the sexual with me. If you're too risky, so tiptoe through the sexual with me.
I got you down.
Ha ha ha.
Hi, I'm Aaron Somers, and you know what? You got me talking on the passion phone. Tell me the story about how you got blown. I got you down. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Holy cow. I'll tell you once more before I hang up the phone. I got you down. The lines are jammed up. Yeah, there isn't a doubt. Call up and tell me what it's all about. I got you down. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Holy cow. I'll tell you once more before I hang up the phone. I got you down. 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 Here on the show, there's a new topic each night. Who do you have sex with? Were they black or were they white? I got you down. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Holy cow. I'll tell you once more before I hang up the phone. I got you down.
And then also there was Tron. I went to see Tron.
How was
my
Tron?
My movie review. Here's my movie.
Did you do IMAX 3D?
The short version. We did Oakwood 3D. Ooh. If you're looking for a movie to go see on shrooms,
yeah,
go see Tron. If you're looking for a good movie to go see something else.
I see.
A movie, by the way, we took the light cycles up a notch. You know, the whole light cycle that was very popular. What can beat the light cycles? Light planes. Planes that leave light trails, blue and red, and if you cross over one of their trails, you blow up. So they're trying to cut each other off and doing, like, double helixes and everything and trying to do, like, dog fighting, and it was really cool. Really cool at the beginning when he first goes into Tron World, and then talk and talk and talk and talk and talk.
Too much talking.
It was about as good as the original.
Right, and then towards the end, actually better than the original because it had more of the cool things. The only thing good about the original is, ooh, cool video.
The original sucked. Everybody's talking about it. Oh, Tron, cult classic. No, man, nobody liked
Tron. The only thing that was good about the original was the light cycles and all the cool glowy things. Glowing things moving.
Not as good as the black hole.
Well, what about, hey, wait a second. The black hole was great. That old
robot. I walked out of it. I walked out of it. It was one of the few movies.
The black hole, yeah.
I can't remember walking out of any other movie.
What about that little old robot that was all beaten up and everything? You didn't have compassion.
Fuck
him?
That guy.
That's terrible.
Although Maximilian the Red Robot, yeah. But towards the end, as you get towards the end of the movie and they're making the big run for the portal and everything, there's a lot of action with glowing things moving.
What about the video game?
But for Disney, that was a great movie.
Did you like that?
I was an ace at the Tron video game.
I was okay.
I smoked it. Not as good as I was at Phoenix, the one with the bird shit on you.
Ooh, Phoenix was really good.
That was mine. Very unusual game.
From planet to planet?
Yeah, I was very good at Phoenix.
From Neptune to Uranus?
Better at Phoenix than any other game. Better than Donkey Kong. Better than Tempest. Phoenix was my game.
What was my best game?
And I played them all.
I had a period where I was really good at Joust.
Joust was a favorite of mine.
I was really good at Joust for a while.
Joust guy. I was obsessed with Joust for a while.
Yeah. And if you could stand
in Pontiac Tempest.
Oh, okay, so my experiment had failed, Boca Brian. It's still doing that same shit, so it's definitely their network. God damn it. Although the good news is I got the old version of Skype back, and at least I know how to use that.
Excellent.
That's a good thing. Very exciting day today. So you didn't see the Tron?
I didn't see anything, man. I haven't seen anything.
Go see it on Shrooms.
Go do something. Spend PlayStation. No way, man. I sit in my house under my table with a...
Yeah,
with a,
waiting for the apocalypse.
Exactly.
Waiting for 2012.
That's so sad.
It is pathetic.
2012, that's the year.
It is pathetic.
I wish I was making as much money as I am having fun. You know, if I made money with my penis, I'd be rich.
I feel bad having fun when there's no money.
I don't. That's how I deal with it, and I'm not spending money to have fun.
Oh, man, there's every time you step out of your house, you spend money.
You got to do it right. I'm learning how to do it cheaper and with other people's money. For example, in Radio Land, we got the whole free admission thing. Like, we go down to Tobacco Road. You think I'm paying any money for that? You know, you have a burger and a beer and you leave.
I like it down there. That's a nice area.
It is nice.
Oski. The MIA.
I am feeling good about that. Alan Michaels is here.
Oski. I want to say hi to Oski.
I don't have to say anything when Alan is here. He just keeps talking.
I do my own show.
What are you doing with that microphone there, Alan?
This mic, I want to tell you, it's the end of the year, and I want to present this to you, and there's an interesting story about this microphone. This microphone in 1967 and 1968 was the microphone in the main master control room at WABC New York.
Really?
Wow. This has been presented to me to present to you to use on SoFlow Radio
Get
2011.
Out. Get out.
And this mic is more sensitive than the mics that we currently use. This is Cousin Brucey's old microphone. I present it to you now.
Oh, my God. I don't even think I'm worthy to touch it.
It has a spittle on there. Happy New Year.
Oh, look, it's got little EQ settings and everything on here.
77 WABC.
Are you recording this?
I can guarantee you we are the only internet radio station in the world to have a microphone that was used by WABC New York.
I'll take back most of the things I said about you. I have a little bit of a tear. Let me pull my condom off here. And I'm gonna do the microphone switch.
Oh, I hope it works.
Wow, let's see what happens. We're gonna say, okay, George, give us a little
here.
Georgie. Let's hear some free flowing George.
He sounds like Dan Ingram when he turns it
the
on.
The previous microphone, George. Go ahead.
One bright day in the middle of the night, two dead boys got up to fight.
All right, that's George on the
Dan
previous SoFlo microphone, and now the Alan Michaels WABC.
I hope he doesn't sound like
microphone.
Chuck Leonard.
Oh, who knows how it's gonna work out? It could turn out terrible.
No, but work.
Okay, here he's back.
Oh, I might have to play with the equalization. What do you think about that? Back to back.
How's it sound, Brian?
Drew their swords and shot each other.
Oh, it sounds great. Sounds mellow and warm.
Very warm and mellow. How about
here? This will blend
that
well.
That microphone was on the air during the blackout in New York. Very famous New York blackout.
Son of Sam.
Hello again.
Well, I'm very honored to have this microphone. We can play with the little EQ.
Now you sound like Herb Oscar Anderson.
EQ settings, isn't
it?
I feel a little bit higher pitch. Do I need to play with the EQ on it a little bit? Because it's got some built-in.
Yeah, you need some balls, dude.
Yeah, I know what's missing. The reverb.
Drop it down.
How about now?
You gotta have reverb.
How about now?
Yeah, that's so great.
You know, you mentioned that.
Now it's totally flat.
You mentioned the blackout.
Yeah.
That is impressive. How about now?
Oh, that's awful.
Well, Dan Ingram was on the air, and he's playing a song, and the song starts to slow down. And it's sounding like a record.
I have
on
that
the
air
speed.
Check.
Let's hear it, Boca.
And he's looking at it, going, what the heck is going on?
Domino's Pizza. How's that?
Sounds better, Georgie.
Yeah.
Yeah,
he equalized it a little bit.
You know, it's amazing how many people are tuned into that blackout to WABC, and they're likely their whole connection to what's happening in the world was going through that microphone at that time in New York.
Do you have any documentation of this?
Yeah.
Where
take a look. There's videos on YouTube.
I think that's
people
great.
Can go to right now that show
the blackout. Also, we have a website, wabctribute.com. You can go there and view a video of the blackout, and you see Dan Ingram sitting there talking into that mic.
This mic here.
That's right.
I think you sound pretty darn good there, Georgie.
I might have to give myself a little bit of
a level. Everyone's Gone to the Moon was the song he was playing.
That's right. That's
right. Which was slow as it anyway. And then as the power was going, it was a cart machine.
Wow, right.
So the cart was slow. Everyone's
that's
gone
it. To the Moon. And poor Dan didn't know what was going on. He's like, what the heck?
They got a lot of EQ settings.
How
on
many
here.
Switches are on that thing?
There's like two dip switches on here, and I like saying dip switch. Let me try.
So they stay and make Dan go to the transmitter site.
Me before
he ended up having
he
power.
Just doesn't stop. What sounds better?
You're stepping on his exit.
I'm sorry.
What sounds better? This right here, or this right here? I like this right here.
I think
it's flat.
It's like a visit at the eye doctor.
I like neither.
Yeah.
I think you were better 2 minutes ago. Whatever you
on the old mic.
On the old mic.
Not on the old mic.
No, this mic right here. This is it. This is just flat. This is just the raw microphone.
Oh.
With nothing set up. I like it the way it sounds right now.
Okay, leave it.
Well, you know they had all that reverb on ABC. You sounded like you're coming from a tin can.
Yeah.
You know,
also we have an equalizer over here. I can do things like tweak and give myself a little bit more bottom.
George has been known to tweak.
But that doesn't make me a twink, just so you know.
Twinks,
how's that?
Twinks and bears?
There we go.
Ron Lundy is turning in his grave.
So, while we're all here, because Joe Castello was one of my... when we did have the swing club connection, and I just... It doesn't matter how many times I say to the audience that I never swung... I'm just going to have that reputation forever. Joe Castello, just so the audience knows, and you can back this up, after my wife decided that it wasn't fun for her anymore because she hates fun, well, let me rephrase that. She hates me having fun. She would rather, she'll suffer not having fun if that's what it takes to prevent me from having fun. So she's like, I don't want to do it anymore. And Joe and his crew, we all had a crew, Joe and his crew were calling me up going, hey, we're going to go out there tonight. Are you guys going to join us? And I would have to say, and this is what you have to verify, Joe, I would have to say, no, I'm sorry, my wife won't let me go out. Yes or no? I would have to say, I can't go. Joe would call me and invite me and say, hey, me and the peeps are going to the trapeze tonight. Are you coming? And I would have to say, no.
That's
I'm
true.
I'm not allowed to go out
that
there.
We reached out to George several times to invite
several
him to
times,
come
and I missed a lot of really, really fun times.
Oh, my God.
But now
you missed the best time.
Alan is back in touch with the trapeze. Maybe we should revive that a little bit. I know I have
Joe Castello night at the trapeze.
Hey,
I like it.
I have a career. I've talked to the wife. And
have a pen.
Feels a little bit different now, and she's like, okay, maybe if we go on gangbang night and I can be the pivot person, okay.
Huh.
That way we'll know.
You know, you frighten me when you say that kind of stuff.
It's true. But she won't have anything to do with Alan or anybody that looks like that.
You're going
to
sit there and hold your wife's hand while a bunch
there
of dudes
he goes again.
Jump on and rail
no,
out
they
a big
have
line.
Way different. They have totally separate rooms back there.
They do. And now,
it's
you know
very
what's
nice,
different
Joe.
From the old trapeze? There's a singles part in the back room. I'm talking about the back room. There's a singles part and a married part. Where in the old trapeze, it was just one big
what
thing.
The old trapeze, new trapeze. What do you mean the new? Where is this? Is it in the same place?
It's around the corner from the old place.
Right.
They've got a married section and
they
a single section.
They do. And I wandered into the married section. They told me, get out.
That's discrimination.
Gee, I wonder why they said that.
This might be it.
What, the erection song?
The blackout.
Particularly slow to you.
That's it.
Bugs me so much. I'm a bass.
You know what this mic doesn't have? On off switch. All the rest of them do.
It's Sky to the Moon by Jonathan King. I think in the key of R right there. Something in one of the cracks anyway. Well, we'll straighten it out. Anyway, that's number 9 this week. What can I tell you? 21 minutes past 5 o'clock. The equipment in here says Signal Corps 19-2. Well, thank you, Signal Corps. Ladies, whether your husband makes his way home in a crowded 7th Avenue subway train, walks to your midtown apartment, dashes to make the 545, or is chauffeured up the West Side Drive, one dinner time pleasure is common to them all, and that's the wholesome goodness of farm fresh butter.
Yeah, that's what's missing. You need reverb on that mic.
This blackout is brought to you by...
What was AM?
I'm still very honored to be
sound better than
Cousin Bruce's microphone.
So you're telling me that what we just heard was broadcast through that microphone?
Yeah, because that mic was the control room mic.
So, yeah.
It's amazing.
But what happened was they blackout. They lost power at the studio and had to go to New Jersey, where the WABC transmitter site was, to finish the rest of the blackout.
Hey, ladies, your husband is out there being murdered by the Son of Sam right now.
Yeah. Well, that came years later. But
speaking of that, I have the 77 blackout air check, too.
We should have a blackout in South Florida.
Back in those days, there were fewer channels to listen to, so, of course, the mass audience was listening to ABC during the blackout. Like in in the old days
have
of TV radio here, the way there used to be three TV channels to watch only. Went back in the days when Rick Shaw had the sock hop on Channel 10, everybody watched them because there were three channels to watch.
Does anybody out there know what the heck we're talking about? Are we just fascinated by an older age?
Thank you, Joe.
Still alive. Oh,
Jack Daniels.
You have been humiliating me on the air for a long time, because the one time that George comes to my studio was the day we decided to do a terrible rum drink. And
that was a great show.
It was a great show with terrible alcohol.
It was a great show. And it's still available in the archive, incidentally.
That's right.
But so I decided to go hardcore Americana, Jack Daniels, couple of glasses, which I think will do well here in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
Merry Christmas to you, George.
Thank you, Joe Castello. You know, and I'm really excited about this microphone. I just, you know, when I tweak it, Cousin Brucey's old microphone. That's what this is.
That's huge.
That is huge.
More important, Dan Ingram. Dan Ingram, was the big production voice of all the big national commercials in those days on TV. Yeah.
And he used this crispy, crunchy AKG microphone.
It's its home at SoFlo Radio.
That's nice. As it continues, as
you're
the tradition
hanging in
lives
there, man.
On,
SoFloRadio,
one mic at a time.
Yeah, well, everything's migrating to the internet anyway. It's just about putting the programming on and getting people to notice.
Just
it
ahead of the curve, George.
Yeah, well, they'll all be over here eventually. Well, we're just here first.
That's what I was going to say. No longer is he ahead of the curve. He was ahead of the curve, but now everyone else is catching up.
Mm-hmm.
Think about it. You just had people in the studio. Lawrence. He's doing things on the web, and everyone's doing things on the web. Everyone is catching up, and so now it's a matter of keeping the edge. Keeping that edge, staying ahead.
Right.
What do you always say, George, about if you're not growing your audience is shrinking?
Right. That's the law of diminishing returns that Neil would always talk about. You have to have promotion, have to have outside promotion. You can't just be preaching to the choir all the time because they die and move away.
Impart some Neil wisdom, George. Let's hear some Neil wisdom.
Length of listenership. Don't telegraph what you're going to be doing. The only way to keep the audience listening is to not tell them what you're going to be doing. Every time that you tell the audience what you're going to be doing after the break, you're inviting them, a certain segment of the audience, to tune out, and that segment is always great.
So when I say, hey, coming up after the break, we're going to do this, that's against Neil.
He doesn't like that. The only way to keep them there is to not tell them what's going on. So the only way that they can find out is to be there, listening, after the commercial break.
All right,
don't telegraph what you're going out. Chronics, this is a quote, chronics are the death knell of a radio show, of a talk radio show. That's why Neil was very anti-chronic. And, the Bird would put the chronics on, and that, you know, more than the temper tantrums, more than the other stuff that happened while Neil was there, it was that. It was what happened when Neil wasn't there that really aggravated him. It was how Glenn would destroy the show by letting the chronics on.
Bye.
Thank you very much. Boca Brian.
Is the South Florida Radio Network.
Hold on. That went off too soon. Sorry.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm looking at the server clock. Okay, thank you, Boca Brian. Thank you, Joe Castello, Alan Michaels, Monica, of course.
Thank you, Craig Worthy,
and Steve Kane for coming in today. Just wait. You're going to be hearing Steve Moore here, me there. It's going to be crazy.
Bye-bye.
This is the South Florida Radio Network.